Good morning. The committee will come to order. Pursuant to notice, the Committee on Science and Technology meets to consider the following measure, H.R. 2407, the National Climate Service Act of 2009. The need for a climate service has been evaluated by both the National Academy of Sciences and the Science Advisory Board of the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. During their last year in office, the Bush administration began exploring the option of creating a national climate service with NOAA as the lead agency. The new administration has also indicated their interest and intention to move forward with a national climate service. State and local governments, private industry, and resource managers across the country recognize that weather and climate impacts influence many aspects of our lives. We have built infrastructure, projected water availability, developed cropping systems, and managed coastal resources, assuming a range of weather and climate is undergoing change. Some of these changes will be positive and offer new opportunities. Others will present challenges. Without more specific information about the magnitude and direction of these challenges, we will be able to direct, prepare, and exploit new opportunities and to adapt to these new challenges. That's why we need a climate service. H.R. 2407 recognizes the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration will play a central role in a national climate service. NOAA has a comprehensive weather and climate observation network and maintains the nation's historic climate record. NOAA also has an extensive network of regional and local offices delivering weather and climate information and established partnerships with state climate offices, private sector weather providers, universities, and other organizations with experience in developing and delivering information on weather and climate. H.R. 2407 establishes a climate service office at NOAA to coordinate the work of the different line offices that are essential into developing and delivering climate services. The bill also establishes an advisory committee to ensure continued input from both the scientific community and the broader stakeholder community to NOAA as climate service evolve. H.R. 2407 provides congressional direction and input to the process of further expanding climate services at NOAA. However, as we heard from our witnesses and from others who have offered comments on this legislation, NOAA cannot do it all. The administration does not require additional authorization to move forward with their plans. However, I believe if they are to be successful in their efforts to this committee should be engaged in the process of developing National Climate Service. Today, we will add an interagency component to H.R. 2407 that will establish a National Climate Service through a process that will ensure ongoing communication between Congress and the administration as they move forward. It will also ensure that many stakeholders throughout the country who need this services will be a part of the process. Staff discussions began over a month ago on this legislation. There have been a number of meetings and discussions over the past few weeks. A text has been shared with the minority during the development of the bill. These meetings resulted in several amendments that will be offered today. Mr. Barrett and Mr. Inglis will offer an amendment to fill the need for an interagency effort that was discussed at the subcommittee markup. I also would like to acknowledge the efforts of Dr. Ehlers, a longtime champion of NOAA, whose staff was also part of these deliberations. And I want to thank all the members for their participation in this afternoon and for their efforts to improve this legislation. And I hope that we will have a broad support for H.R. 2407 and that we will continue to work together as we go forward. Now I recognize Mr. Hall for any of his opening remarks.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to reiterate comments I made at the subcommittee markup. This committee has a very important role to play in any climate debate, and our members' input should not be eliminated in favor of any expediency. The letter I sent to the Speaker outlining just a few of the provisions in the original Waxman-Markey discussions draft that I believe this committee should mark up has not been acted upon. You and I serve on the Committee on Energy and Commerce, but this doesn't diminish the fact that the members of this Committee on Science and Technology should be afforded opportunity to discuss, to debate, and amend the provisions in our sole or shared jurisdiction. The committee's expertise and knowledge should inform and determine whether and how to implement an economy-altering regulatory regime that, at its very core, will require accurate scientific observations, monitoring, and verification of emissions of greenhouse gases. I note that H.R. 2454, upon introduction, received referral to 8 committees, including ours. Will we be marking up these provisions in our jurisdiction found in the Markey-Waxman bill and the version as reported by the Committee on Energy and Commerce? As to the task before us today, our committee held a single hearing on the topic of a national climate service at the subcommittee level. 3 weeks ago, we had a subcommittee's markup. Now we move to mark up the National Climate Service Act of 2009 at the full committee, and I'm still not convinced this legislation solves the problem. Again, I say we should be cautious in moving forward until a reliable and cohesive national infrastructure for monitoring and modeling climate variability is in its place. I don't believe the products and services provided by a National Climate Service have been adequately explained to this committee. What are these climate products and services? Who's delivering them? And we're well aware of drought forecasts and other physical science products, but we've also been told that climate products and services require the expertise and knowledge of a myriad of disciplines, including meteorology, hydrology, oceanography, forestry, agriculture, human health, demographics, public policy, civil engineering, business, and finance, just to name a few. We need to understand what these products and services are before we mandate this establishment of a National Climate Services, is my belief. It's my understanding that both the NOAA and OSTP have existed, existing authority to create a National Climate Service and are in the process of doing so. We should certainly assert our legislative authority over this administration's proposals. However, language in the bill is phrased in such a way that we may be providing greater latitude than intended. If we are of a mind to authorize what the administration is already doing, then I'd suggest we start by authorizing NOAA through a NOAA Organic Act like the one Dr. Ehlers offered at subcommittee a few weeks ago. And I have to say that I have serious reservations about this bill being dropped into H.R. 2454, the Waxman-Markey cap and trade bill. This fact, the very fact that this bill will be slipped into the larger climate bill, making its way through the House, ensures that it's intended to be an even larger force than we were led to believe. The language in H.R. 2407 seems to be constructed in a way to allow for all of the evolution of a national climate change service. This service would not only provide products and services to help inform decisions on what crops to plant based on drought forecast or how much hydroelectric power may be relied upon for electricity generation in the face of variability in precipitation patterns, but also as part of the Waxman-Markey bill could be expanded to be used to advance a regulatory regime that will be disastrous for our country's economic variability. Next, there's been a misconception that Republicans are against the science behind climate change. This notion is not accurate. It's true that climate varies over time. The amendments Republicans offered at subcommittee and the ones we offer today are intended to ensure that we get the best data and information possible. These amendments are intended to make sure that Congress has an active hand in the development of a national climate service that has significant implications whether or not it's inserted into the larger cap and trade bill. These amendments make sure that the existing responsibilities at NOAA are not forgotten in the face of a brand new service. And finally, these amendments are intended to make sure that the technology and infrastructure upon which this whole concept relies is up to the task. Mr. Chairman, I thank you. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Does anyone else wish to be recognized? If not, I ask unanimous consent that the bill is considered as read and open to amendment at any point, and that the members proceed with the amendments in order of the roster. Without objection, so ordered. I guess I should do this. The first amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Washington, Mr. Baird. Dr. Baird, are you ready to proceed with your amendment?
Indeed, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment at the desk.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 575, offered by Mr. Baird of Washington and Mr. Inglis of South Carolina.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So ordered. I recognize the gentleman for 5 minutes to explain the amendment.
I thank the chair, and I want to begin by thanking Mr. Inglis and Mr. Ehlers for their input at the hearing, which we held a week before last. As we heard from witnesses at that hearing earlier last month, the delivery of climate products and services should involve multiple agencies within the federal government. Our amendment outlines a process to engage the relevant federal agencies in an effort to develop the appropriate federal model for delivering climate services. The amendment defines a 3-year process for evaluating alternatives and selecting an interagency structure for a national climate service, receiving public and congressional input on the proposed structure, and finally establishing the national climate service. The amendment requires the president to initiate an interagency development process for a national climate service within 30 days of enactment of this bill. The amendment directs the president to conduct this process through an existing interagency committee, the Committee on Environment and Natural Resources of the National Science and Technology Council. The director of the Office of Science and Technology Policy is to lead this effort for the administration. Within 1 year of enactment, the committee is to complete a survey of the needs of current and future users of information on climate variability and change for each federal agency that will be part of a national climate service. The user survey is similar to the one mandated for NOAA and would compile the findings of similar surveys done by other relevant federal agencies. This is intended to ensure that we have a comprehensive picture of the current situation with respect to the user community, as well as initial information about future demands that will be made of a national climate service. In addition to the user survey, the amendment directs the interagency committee to consider a number of key issues and to report to Congress and the public on the results of deliberations within 2 years of the date of enactment. The amendment, essentially, what we're trying to do, to jump to the point of it all, there were two main issues raised during the last hearing. One, we don't want to duplicate and we don't want to overlap existing agencies that are providing these services. And two, we don't want to just leave it so nebulous that we don't have some focus to make sure people play together, really, so to speak. They work together well as grown-ups. We've seen that happen to detriment. Mr. Ehlers raised this issue about how we've seen failures that result from that. So what we're trying to do is put OSTP in charge of this. Make sure the agencies work well together, make sure we've got a survey of the needs of the users, and that we have a diligent process by which to establish this climate service. I appreciate, again, the input of Mr. Inglis, Mr. Ehlers, and I think this is consistent with the feedback we heard at our hearing. And with that, I would...
Would the gentleman yield for a question?
I'd be happy to yield.
Would be your inclination to support... inclusion in your efforts, a requirement that not only they talk, that the information about the climate viability be made public, but also the fact that there would be analysis of the natural forces as well as other forces that are at work in establishing these climate predictions.
I don't have any problem. I mean, the purpose of the climate service is not exclusive to anthropogenic or natural, is to look at broad changes in climate. So including both natural and anthropogenic, I personally don't have a problem with.
So let me assume then from your answer that we are not really taking a stand on man-made global warming here, but we're making a stand on there's a study into climate and perhaps the natural forces that affect climate, and that information being made available to the public.
Sure. The climate service, I appreciate the gentleman's question, the climate service should look at all the various aspects that might influence climate. That could include volcanoes, include forest fires, and it could include anthropogenic CO2 or methane, et cetera. I think they all combine. We may or may not disagree on that, but there's nothing in the bill that prevents, in fact, it'd be foolhardy to do so.
So I see that we're not in disagreement.
We're not in agreement, no disagreement at all on that issue.
Thank you.
Thank the gentleman for the clarification. With that, Mr. Chair, I would yield back with time and urge passage of the vote.
Is there further discussion on amendment? Mr. Inglis is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I
I'm sorry, was it Inglis or Ehlers?
Inglis, sorry about that.
Okay,
Dr. Ehlers.
Yeah, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At the Energy and Environment Subcommittee hearing on the National Climate Services at NOAA, we discussed the need to promote cooperation among federal, regional, and state entities outside of NOAA in the development of a national climate service. Though NOAA is the leading provider of weather and climate information, a comprehensive national climate service will also draw on the resources and climate information services provided by these other entities as well. This amendment directs the National Science and Technology Council through the Committee on Environment and Natural Resources to create a national climate service that caters to a broad range of user groups and stakeholders that go to the federal government for climate information. Interagency coordination will leverage our federal climate resources and capabilities and provide a national climate service that is sufficiently versatile and flexible to adapt to the informational needs of the user community. This amendment strengthens the aim of the National Climate Service, and I urge the committee to support its passage. And I yield back the balance of my time, Mr. Chairman.
Any further discussion? Dr. Ehlers is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Several questions, and I'm just trying to clear up a little confusion here. First of all, Mr. Hall made an observation about this becoming part of the cap and trade bill. I don't know what the number is. But is that truly the purpose of what we're doing here, or is this something that we're trying to do to keep up with the so-called cap and trade bill, or what's the relationship between the two? And I'm also, I have some other reservations, but if anyone can answer that,
I'd appreciate it. If the gentleman would yield, this is not on the amendment, but on the bill itself. It really serves two purposes. As we mentioned earlier, the administration has the ability to develop a climate service without any kind of legislative authority. The question is, do we feel like that with our input that they can do a better job, as well as, quite frankly, developing the legislative history so that we have more impact on it in the future? So that's one part of the question. Secondly, is this to be a part of a so-called cap and trade bill, or what's going on here? There is a placeholder in the energy bill, the climate change bill, for a weather service. So if that goes forward, this will be at least what our role is in legislating that climate service. Finally, if there is not an energy bill of some type, then this bill would go forward standalone. Does that answer the gentleman's question?
Okay, so this will go to the floor, or this will go to the whole House, and will either be incorporated in the energy bill, if one exists, or will be brought to the House with the help of the Rules Committee as a standalone bill.
That is my intention. I don't always get my intention, you know, but that is my intention, and I think that's what will happen.
Well, it's nice to know someone besides me doesn't always have their intentions fulfilled. Let me just pursue this a little bit. And we've discussed this before in subcommittee, and I've expressed the same concerns, that we're basically turning over to OSTP the structure of this, and whatever they determine is just going to be it. And I guess I'd like to be aggressive with the jurisdiction of this committee. And I'd like to be aggressive in terms of specifying exactly what we want. And that's what I thought we were aimed at when we originally started discussing this in subcommittee. And in fact, I've offered an amendment to really try to clarify the relationship between the administration and the Congress on the formation of this and who would do what and so forth. I see us sort of tossing this into the wind and hoping OSTP does what we want with it. Am I?
I don't, if the gentleman would yield, I don't think that's accurate at all. Not that you're trying to misrepresent anything. Again, the administration can develop this service on their own. I think that we really are stepping forward with our jurisdiction to lay out a good pattern and what we're doing. Otherwise, we would leave it to them completely. Now the question of OSTP. This is NOAA will have a big role here, but it's going to be a multi-agency group that will provide this information. And I'll just say, you know, I'm maybe part of the villain here if you think this is bad, Dr. Ehlers. We've all sat through hearings on NEPOs and all the money that's been wasted. And I think to a great extent that's because nobody was really in charge. You know, you had a coalition of folks, and there really wasn't someone in charge. Yeah. We need somebody in charge to say, you got to show up, you got to go forward. And I think OSTP is that logical place when you have multi-agency jurisdiction in this regard. And so I just don't want to see another INPOS debacle.
Mr. Chairman, if I may respond, I certainly don't want to see one either. It's been one of the hottest shouting matches ever here.
Oh, it's been horrible.
With that. Yeah. It was a mess. But I noticed in the amendment, as I read it, it requires the director of OSTP within 1 year to complete a survey of the needs. It requires the director of OSTP within 2 years to report to the president and Congress. And requires the president within 3 years to establish a national climate service. I don't really have that much problem with that, except I would like it to, at least that the reports go to the going to the Congress be assigned to this committee, so that this committee, in fact, is a committee of jurisdiction dealing with the issue. And I'd feel much better if we could at least specify that, so we can give feedback to the OSTP at these various points, 1 year, 2 year, 3 years, whether or not what they're doing is in agreement with what our intent was. And the way it is, we're just handing it over to them and saying, you can do anything you want, and we'll just have to accept it. Now, that may be true that we have to.
If the gentleman would yield, once again, they have the authority right now to do this without us. What we're doing is we're really becoming a part of that process. And in the legislation, it does require a report to Congress. It does not say specifically the Science and Technology Committee, it says report to Congress. But by virtue of what we're doing today, we are the committee of jurisdiction, and that's who they would have to report to.
Even if this ends up being part of the energy bill and there's no mention of the
yes, of our committee? Yes, correct. Yes. Because we're setting up within agencies of our jurisdiction, OSTP.
Mm-hmm.
No, that's what's happening. I think that I hope that it's not being inartfully done. I think it's being done well done. But I really think it does speak to your concerns.
All right. Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Paul's recognized.
He did not yield back his time. He simply thanked you. May I ask him a question? Dr. Ehlers, what happened to your amendment that you offered on subcommittee a few weeks ago? Was it defeated?
I forget whether it was defeated. Yeah, it was.
And you were suggesting authorizing NOAA through a NOAA Organic Act.
I was trying to bring the two together.
Yes.
Obviously, if the NOAA Organic Act had been, which did pass the House but was not passed by the Senate, that would have taken care of much of it.
Yeah, I don't have an affidavit from anybody that they're going to merge it into the Waxman-Markey bill. I'd feel a lot better if they were merging the Waxman-Markey bill into the Barton bill. But I don't think that's going to happen. But I didn't remember what had happened to your amendment, but I remember you sent it up and spoke well on it.
Well,
you were given adequate time.
Chairman Baird can give the correct answer. Well,
at least one was withdrawn. I think they were both withdrawn on the proviso that we worked together. And we hope that this the commitment on the NOAA Organic Act continues strong in my regard, that we would try to move that separately from this legislation. We hope that this would address some of the concerns about NPOs that Chairman Gordon addressed, and I want to respond to Dr. Ehlers' comments. I think it's it's absolutely right. We do not want to just throw this to the wind and say, well, administration, have your way with it. I think what we want to do is have a very diligent process where we work closely with them, and the reporting back requirements allow us to do that. At the same time, I think we felt, as we discussed things with the administration and looked at the various agencies historically, for us to say, well, this agency shall do this and this agency shall do that, might not actually lead to the best result. It might be better to have the administration work together with their agencies, structure it, report back to us, and then we work with them. But it's by no means just have at it, do what you want.
Okay. I yield back my time.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I have a amendment of the second order. At the desk, I think.
The record will report the amendment.
Amendment offered by Mr. Bill Bray of California. This is a second degree amendment to the amendment offered by Mr. Baird and Mr. Inglis.
Okay, first of all, Mr. Chairman, let me reflect the comments of my colleagues on this committee. I served on the energy.
Will the gentleman suspend?
Yes.
Has the amendment been distributed? Okay. If the gentleman wait just a moment so everybody can have the benefit of seeing your amendment. All right, we're about to get this through. I would say if there are additional amendments or when they come up, let's have our team ready to get them out quickly so we can move forward. And I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So order to recognize the gentleman for 5 minutes to explain his amendment.
Mr. Chairman, I think that the fact that this bill may be tied to the Mr. Waxman's bill really raises a concern for me, who had to work with Mr. Waxman's legislation that he developed in the 90s. I think that this committee and science is essential to make any policy statement about it, be it climate change or energy utilization. I think all of us remember that the Energy and Commerce Committee went off in the 90s without touching base with good science, and we ended up with a mandate from the federal government that products like MTBE be required to put in the fuel. If the Energy and Commerce had taken more time to work with this committee at getting good science before they started passing bad legislation, we could have avoided not only major environmental but also economic impacts here. My bill is quite clear. After consultation with groups like my own Scripps Institution of Oceanography, the wording in reference to the inventory of research capabilities is very light in this bill, and I'd like to strengthen it so that we point out that we not only need an inventory of what's out there, but we need to have an assessment of what it does and what it can do, and an early warning system that what we need to do proactively to make sure that the monitoring system that gets the data, the actual observations that are the foundation for the modeling, is actually operational, not just today or tomorrow, but in the future as we monitor this issue. So basically, this amendment is not only supported by my own local scientists. In fact, let me remind you that I was one of the supporters of Triana back in the 90s. But the fact is that the National Institute of Science recommended this kind of strengthening, this kind of wording, so that we make sure that we understand that continuing monitoring and observation is going to be a central part of us being able to have a successful program when it comes to climate change. And so I would ask that we consider the addition of the enhanced wording, Mr. Chairman, so that we are actually proactive on this rather than having to say all we're going to do is tell us, figure out what's out there, but not talk about what it does and what it may need to be do in the future.
With the gentleman would yield.
Yes.
The majority and minority council are working together, scouring over almost 1,000 pages of the Energy and Commerce Bill to find those areas of our jurisdiction. You can be well assured that we will try to exert ourselves whenever appropriate there. And I think, again, this climate service is one of those areas. Let me just, I know that that the gentleman is a constructive part of this this committee and is not trying to do mischief, but we only got, we only received this second degree amendment just a few minutes ago. And the policy that I'm going to put forth today is this. Any of these amendments that we have just almost have first impression to, we simply, it's not responsible for us to deal with it without knowing it more. We need to know what we're putting on the floor. And there's also a Democratic amendment in the same situation. So we're doing this in a bipartisan way. So what I would suggest to you is that amendments that have come in at this late date that we haven't had a chance to really go over, I don't think we would be living up to our fiduciary relationship to accept them. So, but I would be happy to continue to work with you as this goes forward.
Mr. Chairman, let me just say this.
You can reclaim your time.
I'm just saying, as somebody who's been chairing, you know, city council meetings, county meetings, and board meetings myself since I was 25 years old, I have never heard of this. You know, you may go into this, but to set this policy after the meeting has started, I wasn't informed that this was going to be a policy the chair was going to invoke at the time of the meeting.
Well, first of all, it's in the rules that you are not required, but that you are requested to have your amendment in 24 hours. Now, if you have chaired, I know you've chaired all these various meetings. If you have chaired all those meetings, as you say you have, then I think it'd be very difficult for you to accept an amendment that came in minutes before that you have not had a chance to review. It's not a policy. I'm just telling you what my.
Yeah, I understand that.
If that. Because I don't want there to be surprises.
The point is, Mr. Chairman, if you were going to invoke it as a requirement, not as a request.
No. It's just I'm telling you that it's not a requirement, but that I'm going to oppose amendments that we haven't had a chance to review.
Well, as the chair, I wish that would have been notified at some time so that we could try to work this out. The timely manner was that could have been made available earlier, I would have made it available earlier. We were working on this, but it was not. There wasn't any intention, but now for the chair to say basically you will oppose anything that doesn't come down the line, then let's change our policy and say if it isn't in within a certain time, we're not going to accept it because de facto the leadership's got the ability to enforce that without it being a policy. And so all I'm saying is, in fairness, is the fact is that all I ask for is the consideration because it wasn't possible to put this together for you earlier.
Okay. Well, if the gentleman would yield,
yes.
Again, in our rules, it's not a mandate because there can always, and we can make it a mandate if you'd like. I think that disadvantages the minority, but we can make it a mandate if you would like. But in our rules, and this was carried over rules from previous administrations, it asked that amendments be in 24 hours in advance. I'll remind you that we've had a subcommittee markup.
Yeah.
This has been out for a long time. We will continue to work with you. I am not telling you that this is the policy that it won't be accepted. I'm just telling you that in terms of me, and this is, again, you're making an honest effort here. I'm trying to be honest with you. I don't think I would be doing my job to allow legislation to go to the floor that we have not had a chance to review
an
amendment.
Mr. Chairman, let me clarify. This is a second-degree amendment to an amendment that's being brought up. The assumption of being able to bring this up at this time is only based on the assumption that the primary amendment would have to be considered.
Mr. Chairman,
you've had this,
this amendment.
I have a solution for you, Mr. Chairman.
the gentleman's recognized for a solution.
In defense of the gentleman from California, I just repeat my poem I've said before. Said the young maiden of Siam to her lover, Yang Kiam, if you kiss me, of course, you'll have to use force, but God knows you're stronger than I am. Then give him a vote on it. You're going to vote it down, and that take less time than listen to both of you argue. though it's educational, I'm enjoying it. And a gentleman that's near my age, even by the time he was 25, had chaired all those boards. I like to hear from him.
Mr. Chairman.
Dr. Baird is recognized for 5 minutes.
I thank the gentleman from California for his diligence, and he offers good input. My concern would be, I think his intent, the words he described are worthy. I have no disagreement at all with the expression of why he's offering the amendment. I think it's meritorious. As I look at the wording of the amendment per se, however, it starts approximating micromanagement, and I think in a way that might be counterproductive. Outlines of specific time periods in which observing infrastructure will be deployed. So I guess we're before this climate service is even created, we're telling them you have to tell us what time frames you will deploy what instrumentation, and we're for reasons which I think may be well in dispute on the scientific community, we're deciding that we will prioritize observing infrastructure given particularly to data poor regions. A priori, there's no necessary reason to assume that data poor regions should be where we prioritize versus data rich regions of greater consequence. So his intent of assuring sound science, I think, is admirable, and I would hope would be fundamental to the institution itself once created. But I don't think this amendment necessarily is constructive, and I think it will actually have the effect of micromanaging. And so, therefore, I would, while sharing the gentleman's concern for sound science as a basis, I would not support the amendment.
Would the gentleman yield?
Yeah, I'd be happy to.
The whole source of this amendment comes from the scientists who are actually in the field, be it the National Academy of Science, be it those individuals that were concerned and worked with us in the 90s on Triana, be it Scripps. They're the people that are concerned. We saw what happened with Triana, is that we didn't micromanage, and the Bush administration came in and gutted the whole program. So this concept that we trust this administration is all fine and dandy, but we've seen what happened in the past. And this is data. These are scientists that are saying we need this clarification, because by just to make sure that the effort is maintained and improved rather than abandoned. And I yield back to the gentleman.
Reclaiming my time, I don't doubt that the gentleman has spoken to some scientists. I think it would perhaps be inaccurate to suggest that this is an official position of the National Academy of Sciences, that this amendment should be adopted. My hunch would be there are other scientists who might well dispute this. And so I recognize that some scientists have undoubtedly, and I admire the gentleman that he speaks to the scientists about this. I would doubt there's uniformity of it, and I would not presume that the scientists from NOAA and all the other agencies that will go into developing this would not have their own input, and presumably actually might well, if indeed the consensus the gentleman describes exists, would very likely coordinate this. Finally, I would say we are by no means just giving all this over to, quote, a good friend of Mr. Rohrabacher's, trust and verify is a more likely, more accurate description of what we plan to do here. And we will verify as they come forward with their climate legislation or their climate service proposal, rather, that they've indeed addressed many of the issues the gentleman has put forward. But to require it a priori, I think, would be actually counterproductive and therefore would urge defeat of the amendment.
Is there further discussion on the amendment? If no, the vote occurs on the amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. No. The nays have it, and the amendment is not agreed to. And let me say, even though the amendment was not agreed to, the amendment is not thrown in the trash. We want to continue to work with you and as we move forward to see if, you know, as, with further review of this, if that any of that can be incorporated.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And as a recycled congressman myself, I'd prefer to recycle this product and see if we can bring it back, okay?
Mr. Chairman, just one inquiry here so we understand where we're coming from. The gentleman's last effort was an amendment to an amendment.
Right.
And we certainly understand the necessity of having our amendments in on time. I think it would be very difficult for us to do the job that we're doing in markup without being able to fine-tune amendments by amendments to amendments. With restrictions on that timing. So is it the chairman's intent that amendments must be in beforehand, but that perhaps we will may seriously consider amendments to amendments in the fine-tuning process?
The gentleman makes a very good point. As I say, the rules, say that it is suggested that amendments be in 24 hours in advance. We could make that a hard, fast one. We kept the rules from the past, and I think it makes some sense because there could be some last-minute information. You're also correct in that a second-degree amendment, certainly there are times, as you say, that needs to be fine-tuned. I hope I don't mean to be misunderstood in the sense that I have no authority and will not intend to rule it out of order, but just to tell you that if there are this was more substantive, I think, than just a fine-tuning, okay. That if we, you know, don't have the opportunity to at least review and feel comfortable about it, just me as one person within this, you know, on this committee, would generally have to oppose. I say that just because, again, I just want everybody to know the situation.
But you would not deny someone the right to offer an amendment to an amendment?
Absolutely not. And not only would not, but don't have the authority to.
Thank you very much.
And would welcome if the amendment said 2 years and you had a amendment said 2.5 years,
right.
I think that's the sort of thing mm-hmm. that is different than a more substantive type of amendment.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. And Ms. Biggers is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I offer an amendment to the gentleman's amendment.
The clerk report the amendment.
Amendment offered by Mrs. Biggert, amendment number 011. This is a second degree amendment to the amendment offered by Mr. Baird and Mr. Inglis.
The amendment has been distributed, so I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading. Without objection, so ordered. I recognize the gentlelady for 5 minutes to explain her amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think that the Baird-Inglis amendment is written so that it presupposes the need for an interagency national climate service. And my amendment would change the language so instead of where it's on page 1, line 9 and 10, it says that the changes the language so instead of evaluating alternative structures, the Committee on Natural Resources and the Environment would instead evaluate the need, ability to establish, and the cost to support the interagency program. I think that this amendment would allow that committee the flexibility to see if this program is necessary to begin with, and second, it would also give us an idea what the cost would be and how easy it would be to establish it. I think that you've laid out a program that is good as far as having a number of years to look at this and everything. But my problem is that it says that within 3 years of enactment and after submitting a report to Congress, the president shall establish a national climate service. And I think that then it makes it, even though, let's say, the study is done, and then they say, well, we don't really need it, but we're mandated to do it. And I would think that we really need to, first, and particularly in the climate that we are in now, the economic climate, and it sounds to me like it is, and it could create a very large agency, in effect, and the cost could be enormous. And I think rather than first take the first step and make sure that we're creating a program that is really necessary, and that study could do that, and then it would proceed to be established.
Does the gentlelady yield back her time? Or?
I would yield to the gentleman.
Thank you. Your points would be well taken were it not for the fact that if we had just started today, if we just came together today and said, gosh, do you think we need a climate service? Your points would be well taken, but in fact, we've had a hearing on this, studies have been done, reports have been written, users have said there's a need for a climate service, various agencies have said we need to better coordinate. The gist of the testimony that we heard in the hearing prior to the markup was that we've already established the need. And so, as I read the gentlelady's amendment, it's basically to go back to square one as if all of that groundwork, the prior studies, the testimony of the witnesses, the experts, et cetera, had never occurred.
Reclaiming my time, I think that I don't think that from the hearings that there really is a consensus. I didn't see that there was established that there really was this need that it might be able to be done other ways. I think, you know, that we need to talk about the climate, but I wasn't sure that this really had been established, nor do we have any idea what the cost would be.
Well, first of all, if the gentlelady would yield I don't recall whether the gentlelady was present during the hearing or not. I was, and I thought, well, you know, if consensus means 100% agreement, it would be rare that we get that here. But if consensus means that the predominance of the people who spoke and the report that was conducted on, which was portion of the basis of the hearing, if the authors of that and the people who contributed to it, yes, indeed, there was a general agreement, okay. If not unanimity, but general agreement that indeed there is a need for it, this survey.
If gentlemen would reclaim my time, I think that there was established that something should be done at NOAA. But I don't think that there was any consensus or agreement that there should be another agency.
If the gentlelady would yield, yes. That's certainly not my reading of the testimony that I was present for. Indeed, there were differences of opinion about where it should reside and precisely how it should be structured. The general, if there was consensus, which I believe there was, it was that some form of integrated climate service is merited, that having accurate estimates and predictions of what likely climate trends were would be in the economic and national security interests of this country, and that the current structures did not adequately coordinate.
If the gentleman would yield.
Indeed.
I think, you know, that this to me is sort of like the Department of Homeland Security, and I think that we probably jumped into that without really establishing how that should be developed, and I'm afraid that this would happen here, and I think that we saw, waste there and how it was going to be established, and it took us a long time to get it going. I think with really having established the need and the cost and everything, that we would be much further along in establishing something if it's demonstrated that there is consensus and there is need.
We may disagree on that, if I may say, and I would urge the gentlelady and others who have questions about the intent of the hearing to consult the record and the transcript of that hearing, and I think they'll reach a different conclusion, but ladies free to offer that.
Reclaiming my time, I don't know how much time I have, but I did want to bring up just an issue on this whole proceeding. I was going to wait for a while, but I think I would like to address it right now. I have real concern about what we have, and I have, you know, having served as a subcommittee chair of this committee, I have the greatest respect for this committee, and I'm concerned that I think that our committee has really surrendered jurisdiction over the full scope of climate change legislation, and I understand, you know, that the draft before us may be a part of the Markey-Waxman bill, along with numerous other provisions in their bill. But I think that a lot of this should have been referred to this committee as the appropriate venue for consideration. Mr. Chairman, I think it bears repeating that Rule 10 of the Rules of the House give the Science Committee jurisdiction over energy technology and commercial application of energy technology, energy and science R&D standards development and the Weather Service, among others. And I think that the Markey-Waxman includes provisions on these issues, and I think that some of the most important provisions there are the standards development for the plug-in hybrid vehicles and building energy efficiency as part of the electric grid, and carbon capture and sequestration research, development and deployment, and international technology funds. So I'm really concerned that we are, you know, that we've given this up, and I think that this
committee... If the gentlelady would yield, it's just the opposite. We are, one, going through with the minority counsel 1,000 pages of the Energy and Commerce Bill to find out, you know, where is our area of jurisdiction. Secondly, we will exert ourselves with the parliamentarian at the proper time. That time has not come yet. Yeah. And finally, we are being proactive here rather than wait until it's referred to us. You know, we are being proactive.
With all due respect, and I know that you serve on the Energy and Commerce Committee also, it just seems like that we're always playing second fiddle to the Energy and Commerce Committee, and that assigned jurisdiction should have been something that we would address, rather than they have already marked up the bill and marked up the issues that I see that I think are jurisdictional here. And I hope that we are going to have some time really to consider all of that. I have not been apprised that we are going to be addressing those issues, but they've already been marked up. How do we then claim the jurisdiction to make decisions that have already been made.
Because on the climate service, there's just a placeholder waiting for us to do our job. And again, the administration has the authority to do this without any legislation. We are being proactive, doing what I think you want done to create this ourselves, and we are getting ahead of the game.
Well, I hope that's true, but as I said, energy and commerce, I think, has really talked about the standards for the vehicles and building energy efficiency as part of the electric grid, and I do think that this is a large part of our jurisdiction. Are we going to change what they've already written, or is this?
Well, to their credit, they accepted most of those areas what we recommended.
But when did we discuss this for recommending those areas?
There was in the as the staff was going through discussions. There was recommendations made, but again, at the end of the day, we will ask for the parliamentarian about what are our areas of jurisdiction.
Well, I would hope that the committee and the members of the committee would be included as well as the staff in making those recommendations.
We would want you to participate, and on my tombstone, there'll be a lot of things written. But giving up jurisdiction won't be one of them.
I would hope so. I would hope as the chairman of this committee that you will fight very hard for our jurisdiction. This is a very important committee.
Is there further discussion on the amendment? If no, the vote occurs on the amendment. All in favor say aye. Opposed, no. No. The noes have it. The amendment is not agreed to. And now I ask unanimous, now we want to vote on the underlying amendment. All in favor say aye. Aye. All no. The ayes have it, and the amendment is agreed to. The second amendment on the roster is, and let me, before we get into the second amendment, we're going to be having votes, four votes very shortly, at which time we'll need to go vote, and we want to like to come back and promptly begin. We'll say hopefully 10 minutes after the end of the last vote. And let me also apologize to you. I have a markup like most of you had across the hall, and that's the reason that I've had to run back and forth some. So let's see if we can get one more done. The second amendment on the roster is a manager's amendment. The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407. Amendment.
Pardon me.
Amendment number 2022 offered by Mr. Gorton of Tennessee.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection, so ordered, and I recognize myself for 5 minutes to explain the amendment as soon as the bells stop ringing. All right, so we can. The manager's amendment makes a series of changes throughout the bill. The changes are primarily to provide clarification and consistencies in phrases and terms used throughout the bill. The amendment also changes the existing text to reflect the addition of interagency component of the bill. NOAA will now have a climate service program everywhere in the bill where it previously read National Climate Service. At the subcommittee markup, Representative Ellers expressed a concern that the director of the climate office might assume too much authority over the leadership of the line office at NOAA, including the National Weather Service. The amendment adds some language to clarify that the director is to collaborate with the leadership of these offices. Also in Section 4, the amendment clarifies language in order to continue the cooperative work amongst the network of regional climate centers, state climate offices, regional integrated sciences, assessment program, and other users and stakeholders. The amendment adds a program element to develop tools to assist end users in their efforts to use the climate products and services that are produced. In Section 7, the amendment removes the cap on the funding of the regional integrated services and assessment team. NOAA informs us that the cap would result in cuts to funding of existing RESA teams. And finally, the amendment alters the timelines for the report to Congress to allow NOAA adequate time to do both the surveys of users and the stakeholders and their use and use this information to develop their implementation plan. This amendment is the product of discussions between minority and majority staff. The amendment improves the bill and ensures NOAA will conduct an efficient climate service program with the ability to productively collaborate with other federal agencies, and I urge my colleagues to support the amendment. Is there further discussion on this amendment? If no, the vote occurs on the amendment. All in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the amendment is agreed to. The third amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from California. Mr. Robacher, are you ready to proceed with your amendment?
Yes, I am, and I think this is a pretty non-controversial amendment as compared to what I could be offering.
The clerk will appoint the report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 014, offered by Mr. Rohrbacher of California.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So ordered. I recognize the gentleman for 5 minutes to explain his amendment.
Well, as I say, this is, I believe, a non-controversial, especially after my dialogue with Mr. Baird earlier about his amendment. It just basically instructs the new National Climate Service or Climate Service Program to include not just climate viability and variability, but also includes the fact that we expect them to offer an understanding of climate in general and the natural forces that affect climate change and climate that's going on. All this is doing, obviously, is ensuring that both the idea that changes in climate happen naturally is not negating that man may have an impact, although I disagree with that. This would just make sure that both sides are presented in any service that we create. That's it.
Thank you, Mr. Robacher. Let me first clarify a misstatement of mine. The majority staff is currently going through the Energy and Commerce Bill, looking for areas of jurisdiction. When that is done, there will be collaboration with the minority staff. Hopefully, with as many heads as possible, we will find the areas of our jurisdiction. With that, going back to your amendment, Mr. Robacher, as was pointed out earlier by Mr. Baird, there's nothing in this amendment or nothing in this bill that would limit NOAA from looking at natural forces. So I don't think that your amendment really is necessary. And it could be even confusing in that some people think you are a natural force, and we would be you don't want to put yourself under too much investigation there. So is there any further discussion on the amendment? If no, then yes, Mr. Hall.
I think he may come under the arbitral changes, but I'm not sure. But I applaud his efforts to ensure that the National Climate Service and climate service programs include the natural forces of climate change. It's simple, and if it enlarges or defines volcanoes, sunspots, orbital changes have affected Earth's climate before humans were here. Even there were hurricanes, droughts, and forest fires that resulted from these changes. This amendment requires that our scientific and research communities advance the understanding of the forces already in existence. I don't think it hurts anything. I think it helps some. I urge my colleagues to support it.
Mr. Chairman.
Is there further discussion on the amendment?
Mr. Chairman.
Dr. Baird is recognized.
Just briefly, as I specified to my colleague from California, I see nothing in the bill as it currently stands that would preclude addressing natural. My fear would be a reading of the language he's potentially substituting might be read to preclude anthropogenic, and that would be something I would definitely oppose. I think we have to look at all sides of it, whereas the initial language, I think, is the more open of the language.
Certainly not the purpose, and in fact, it states that in general and natural forces, and in general would include all effects on our climate, including man-made.
Maybe I'm looking at the wrong language. Is this... Which amendment is it, Mr. Rohrbacher? Page 2, strike lines 1 through 3?
The amendment which expands the role of the National Climate Service is number 3. I think you're looking at number 14.
That may be that I've made a mistake. I apologize for that.
Yeah.
Mr. Rohrbacher, we think this is 14.
Wait a minute. No, are you talking about... My amendment 15, or are you talking about? Okay, you're talking about this amendment.
This amendment number 014.
Okay, and what specific language are you referring to, Mr. Baird? I got it. I have Amendment 3 up here, but then it says 14 here. Okay, got it.
It's the same one.
All right. So what language is specifically that you were worried about there?
I'm sorry, Mr. Rohrabacher. I'm not clear on which the exact language we're talking about here. Can someone just give me a copy of that? I mean, I've got several amendments here. Mine are not numbered in the fashion you're describing yours numbered.
It basically...
I just coordinate
program
what I was
National
reading.
Oceanographic Atmospheric Administration to ensure a timely production...
No, but I'm referring to the first part, Mr. Rohrabacher, the first... Advanced understanding of climate, natural forces that affect climate and climate variability at the national, the omission of anthropogenic, I think, is more of concern to me than the open language of the existing bill.
Oh, well, the purpose of this amendment is to make sure that that's what's included. It's assumed that what you were talking about is already part of the agenda for this new
I see,
assumed
by you.
Climate service. I am assuming that will also be that's part of the agenda. And frankly, this is just to make sure that natural causes for variation are also included.
Well, I would probably I don't know who's got the time, but just personally, I don't think it's. I think it's superfluous. I support the intent of ensuring that natural is. I'm on the record as that ensuring that natural is included in addition to anthropogenic. But would oppose the language here because I think it's largely superfluous and may actually be exclusionary.
Okay.
Is there further discussion on the amendment? If no, the vote occurs on the amendment. All in favor to say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. No. The noes have it. The amendment is not agreed to. I'm afraid we're not going to have time to get into I'm sorry. Do you want to have a vote? Okay. I think the prudent thing to do is for us to go vote. This committee will be called back to order 10 minutes after the last vote on this one. And we are now in recess.
The committee will reconvene. The fourth amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Hall. Are you ready to proceed with your amendment, Mr. Hall?
I have an amendment at the desk.
Clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 147 offered by Mr. Hall of Texas.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection so ordered. I recognize the gentleman from Texas for 5 minutes to explain the amendment.
Mr. Chairman, my amendment would ensure that the undersecretary would not start up a climate service office until the user survey and implementation plan required in Section 8 and 9 have been completed. Right now, H.R. 2407 is drafted in such a way that the Climate Service Office is established at the time of enactment of the bill. The user survey and the implementation plan, both pieces and both of them that my colleagues across the aisle included in the bill during the subcommittee markup, are meant to inform the undersecretary as to the needs, requirements, and structure of the Climate Service Officer at NOAA. This amendment would alter the timeline so that the office is established only after the work to determine what the office should look like is completed. This is a common sense amendment, I think, and I urge all my colleagues to support it. And I thank you, sir. Reserve my time.
I thank the gentleman from Texas. If I may speak to this briefly, the nature of the bill as it's currently drafted is sort of moving on parallel tracks, and I think that's really probably the best way to proceed, in the sense that we're directing these agencies to build the plan for how to structure the service. Simultaneously, basically, they'll be gathering information about how best to serve the needs of the user groups and the scientists involved and others. Much of that latter work is already happening, and my concern about this amendment as proposed is you're basically freezing NOAA activities. You're saying stop doing all the things you're already doing. When it's not as if NOAA and the other agencies are doing nothing. They're in fact doing a great deal, and that work will actually continue. So they have a pretty good sense already, I think, in many levels of what the needs are. That was certainly the testimony we heard. The challenge is to try to find how those needs will integrate, and I think that can move in parallel. So I appreciate the gentleman's points, but think it would actually impede progress on establishing a climate service and impede the ability of the planned service to meet the needs of the constituencies that they serve. And so I would urge a no vote on this amendment. Is there anyone else who wishes to be heard on the amendment? Hearing no other comments, the vote occurs on the amendment. All in favor will say aye. Those opposed, no. The noes have it. The amendment is not agreed.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
That's for record vote.
No, roll call
roll
vote.
Roll call vote.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Chairman Gordon.
Hold on 1 second. We will briefly, because members are instructed by staff, people are still returning from the floor, so we'll postpone the voting for just a few minutes as people are returning from the vote. Committee will be in recess for 3 or 4 minutes, and then once members have a chance to return.
That's fair enough.
Yeah, both sides. You never know when Mr. Flake's going to have another amendment. We have to come back to you.
Could talk on this for 30 minutes.
We're trying to get some of our members here.
You want to hold off for a second?
Can we wait?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Committee will reconvene. I thank folks for their patience while our colleagues return. The vote has occurred on the, been requested, a roll call vote by, on the amendment by Mr. Hall, the gentleman from Texas. The clerk will proceed to call the roll.
Chairman Gordon. Mr. Costello. Ms. Johnson.
No.
Ms. Johnson votes no. Mr. Wu.
No.
Mr. Wu votes no. Mr. Baird.
No.
Mr. Baird votes no. Mr. Miller.
No.
Mr. Miller votes no. Mr. Lipinski.
No.
Mr. Lipinski votes no. Ms. Giffords. Ms. Edwards. Ms. Edwards votes no. Ms. Fudge.
No.
Ms. Fudge votes no. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes no. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Griffith. Mr. Rothman. Mr. Matheson.
No.
Mr. Matheson votes no. Mr. Davis. Mr. Chandler.
No.
Mr. Chandler votes no. Mr. Carnahan. Mr. Hill. Mr. Hill votes no. Mr. Mitchell.
No.
Mr. Mitchell votes no. Mr. Wilson. Mrs. Dahlkemper.
No.
Mrs. Dahlkemper votes no. Mr. Grayson.
No.
Mr. Grayson votes no. Ms. Comas. Mr. Peters.
No.
Mr. Peters votes no. Mr. Hall.
Aye.
Mr. Hall votes aye. Mr. Sensenbrenner. Mr. Lamar Smith. Mr. Roybacher. Mr. Bartlett.
Aye.
Mr. Bartlett votes aye. Mr. Ehlers. Mr. Lucas. Mrs. Biggert. Mr. Aiken. Mr. Nagebeiler. Mr. Inglis. Mr. Inglis votes aye. Mr. McCall.
Yes.
Mr. McCall votes aye. Mr. Diaz-Balart.
Aye.
Mr. Diaz-Balart votes aye. Mr. Bilbray. Mr. Adrian Smith. Mr. Adrian Smith votes aye. Mr. Brown. Mr. Olson.
Aye.
Mr. Olson votes aye.
Are there any members who have not been recorded?
Chairman, I'd like to be recorded as a no.
Mr. Rothman?
Mr. Rothman votes no.
Mr. Tonko?
No.
Mr. Tonko votes no.
Mr. Lucas?
Mr. Lucas? Mr. Lucas votes
aye. Ms. Giffords?
No.
Ms. Giffords votes no.
Any other members wishing to cast a vote or wishing to change your vote? Could the clerk report the tally?
Mr. Chairman, 8 members vote aye and 17 members vote no.
The amendment is not agreed to. The fifth amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Nebraska, Mr. Smith. Are you ready, Mr. Smith, to proceed with your amendment?
Yes, I am.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 005, offered by Mr. Smith of Nebraska.
Ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection, so ordered. Recognize the gentleman from Nebraska for 5 minutes to explain his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members. This amendment would ensure all weather and climate models upon which any climate services and products are based are subject to an open and transparent peer review process that adheres to the principles outlined in the Federal Register date January 14, 2005. The principles outlined in the Federal Registry by the Office of Management and Budget establishes that important scientific information shall be peer-reviewed by qualified specialists before it is disseminated by the federal government. The global climate models, which have been used in the Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change, reports and models we use here in the U.S. are not required to be peer-reviewed. Our country has some of the best science and scientists in the world, but they are in fact only human. Sometimes people make mistakes. Since these models will be a substantive part of products and services provided by a national climate service or climate service program, it is vital to require any such climate model to be critically reviewed by many scientific experts in order to ensure decision makers at all levels of government and in the private sectors are basing their policy choices on the highest quality information. This amendment requires climate models are put through the same rigorous review process that we have come to expect for all important decisions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank the gentleman. Any other members wishing to speak to this? Mr. Thank Miller.
Mr. Chairman, I wish to speak in opposition. I am all for open and transparent peer review. The Oversight Investigations and Oversight Subcommittee has pushed federal agencies to use peer review. But I think it's a very bad idea to tie it to the procedures set forth in the Federal Register that the amendment refers to. The Obama administration is currently reviewing those. The OSTP is reviewing those and will likely revoke them shortly, which will put us in the peculiar position of having tied NOAA by statute to a peer review process that no other agency in the federal government will be using. The reason that the Obama administration is reviewing them is that those were promulgated by the Office of Information and Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs, OIRA, which has been not where OMB enforced sound science. It's where OMB interfered politically with scientific decisions and was frequently guilty of requiring so much analysis that it became paralysis by analysis. And then finally, although we generally encourage peer review with respect to climate forecast, it may not make sense to require a 2-year peer review process before beginning to use them. We need the best, most current science for tornado warnings, for hurricane projections, for rain and crop information, and requiring a 2-year delay for a prolonged, complicated peer review process. While peer review is generally something we want to encourage, may result in using less sound science in the short term, and their important decisions be made in the short term. So I urge the members to oppose this amendment.
Is there further discussion on the amendment?
Mr. Chairman.
Gentleman from Nebraska is recognized.
I would like to just add that this is my effort to make sure that the information that's gathered and disseminated is stands some scrutiny, and obviously if things are in such a hurry that we're willing to act on issues without the best information available. I certainly cannot change that, but I would hope that we could adopt something like this so that we can end up with a better work product. Thank you.
Thank the gentleman. Is there further discussion? Hearing none, the vote occurs on the amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no. The noes have it, and the amendment is not agreed to.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I would ask for a roll call vote.
A roll call vote has been requested. The clerk will call the roll.
Chairman Gordon. Mr. Costello. Ms. Johnson. Ms. Woolsey. Mr. Wu. Mr. Baird.
No.
Mr. Baird votes no. Mr. Miller.
No.
Mr. Miller votes no. Mr. Lipinski.
No.
Mr. Lipinski votes no. Ms. Giffords. Ms. Giffords votes no. Ms. Edwards. Ms. Edwards votes no. Ms. Fudge. Ms. Fudge votes no. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes no. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Griffith. Mr. Rothman. Mr. Matheson. Mr. Davis. Mr. Chandler.
No.
Mr. Chandler votes no. Mr. Carnahan.
No.
Mr. Carnahan votes no. Mr. Hill. Mr. Hill votes no. Mr. Mitchell.
No.
Mr. Mitchell votes no. Mr. Wilson. Mrs. Dahlkemper.
No.
Mrs. Dahlkemper votes no. Mr. Grayson.
No.
Mr. Grayson votes no. Ms. Comas. Mr. Peters. Mr. Hall.
Aye.
Mr. Hall votes aye. Mr. Sensenbrenner. Mr. Lamar Smith. Mr. Roybacher. Mr. Bartlett. Mr. Bartlett votes aye. Mr. Ehlers. Mr. Lucas.
Aye.
Mr. Lucas votes aye. Mrs. Biggert.
Aye.
Mrs. Biggert votes aye. Mr. Aiken. Mr. Nagelbauer. Mr. Inglis.
Aye.
Mr. Inglis votes aye. Mr. McCall.
Aye.
Mr. McCall votes aye. Mr. Diaz-Borlart. Mr. Diaz-Borlart votes aye. Mr. Bill Bray. Mr. Adrian Smith.
Aye.
Mr. Adrian Smith votes aye. Mr. Brown. Mr. Olson.
Aye.
Mr. Olson votes aye.
Mr. Matheson.
Mr. Matheson is not recorded. Mr. Matheson votes no.
Mr. Wu.
Mr. Wu is not recorded. Mr. Wu votes no.
Are there any other members who wish to cast a vote? Mr. Rothman?
No.
Mr. Rothman votes no.
Mr. Tonko?
Mr. Tonko votes no.
Any other members who have yet to cast their vote or wish to change their vote? The clerk will please report the tally.
Mr. Chairman, 9 members vote aye and 17 members vote no.
The motion or the amendment is defeated. The 6th amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentlelady from Illinois, Ms. Biggert. Ms. Biggert, are you ready to proceed with your amendment?
Yes, I am, Mr. Chairman.
Good. The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 036, offered by Mrs. Biggert of Illinois.
I would ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading. Without objection, so ordered. I recognize the gentlelady for 5 minutes to explain her amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My amendment is to include a study of the effects on local communities that utilize non-CO2 power sources. And I appreciate the opportunity to offer the amendment. I'm very disappointed that my efforts to study the local benefits of no carbon sources like nuclear power are not considered by this committee as for the bill. I think that, again, talking about the jurisdiction, I think that this is something that we really need in any bill that we do on climate change, and that is to have nuclear power included in anything. The short term, maybe we can use all of the other alternatives, but in the long term, if we don't have nuclear power in our in this bill or in any of the climate change bills that we will not be able to really meet the objectives that we have, either to reduce our dependence on foreign oil or to be able to reduce the CO2.
Thank the gentlelady. Does the gentlelady yield back?
I think that the amendment would really evaluate the effects of non-CO2 producing power, such as nuclear, on local and regional areas. And I think this is important as we consider the climate variations and air quality. We should recognize the benefits that non-CO2 producing nuclear power can provide as a baseload power source without harmful emissions.
I appreciate the gentleman's point. I'd recognize myself for 5 minutes to respond. The gentlelady has been a passionate advocate of nuclear power, and I respect that very much. I think the question before us today, though, is this really germane and relevant to the functions of a climate service? The function of the climate service is to provide predictive data to users of that information so they can make appropriate plans. It is possibly true that nuclear power will have an influence on those predictions in the sense that it may or may not influence the amount of climate change gases or other factors in the atmosphere, but it is really not the this is not about the climate service is not about the nation's energy policy. It is about what will happen to our climate. I think they're related. Some of our colleagues on this committee seem to not think they're related, but I believe they are. But I don't think this is particularly the place. So, well, the gentlelady is well-intended.
Will the gentleman yield?
I'd be happy to.
Thank you. Again, this is, I think, part of the problem that we're having with this bill and how we're going to, what's going to happen with Waxman-Markey. And I think that this committee should be taking, you know, be in the forefront of discussing some of this energy, and this is about the only place that we've had the opportunity to put it in right now. And so I hope that we will really address this. And if I might insert into the record, this is a letter that was addressed to Speaker Nancy Pelosi and from our ranking member, Mr. Hall, and really goes over a lot of the jurisdictional issues, if I might enter that into the record.
Without objection, so ordered. I thank the gentlelady. Are there other comments that wish to be offered? Hearing none, the vote occurs on the amendment. All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed will say no. The noes have it. The amendment does not pass. We proceed now to the next amendment. The seventh amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Missouri, Mr. Aiken. Mr. Aiken is not here. We will proceed to the next amendment. There are bonus points, by the way, for others who wish to not be here for their the eighth amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from the eighth amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Nebraska, Mr. Smith. Mr. Smith, are you ready to proceed with your amendment?
Yes, I'm sorry I'm here.
I'll not take that one. The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 004, offered by Mr. Smith of Nebraska.
I would ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So ordered. I recognize the gentleman from Nebraska for 5 minutes to explain the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. This amendment would require the National Integrated Drought Information System to coordinate with the state climate offices and regional integrated science and assessments teams to assess management practices and technologies and the effects of both used for drought mitigation at the local, state, and regional levels. Representing a predominantly rural, agriculture-based district in which surface and groundwater, and ultimately drought issues, are the forefront of many decisions and debates, my principal goals are to create policies which will strengthen rural America and provide long-term stability for our nation's producers. My district, along with other areas of the country, has been hit hard in recent years by drought, and I have seen firsthand how important it is to monitor and have steps in place to help mitigate drought. This amendment will ensure NIDIS, state climate offices, and RISA teams, are collaborating together to assess practices and technologies currently used for drought mitigation. Such a practice will benefit all stakeholders enormously. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank the gentleman for his remarks and for what I consider a very constructive amendment that actually highlights precisely the kind of services we believe will be provided by a climate service. Accordingly, I would urge passage of this amendment. Are there other members who wish to comment?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, gentleman from
I'll
Texas.
I'll be very brief. I surely agree with you. This amendment would require the National Integrated Drought Information System Program to coordinate their efforts with the state climate offices, which I think all of us want. And since drought mitigation tools and techniques that work well in Nebraska may also work well in Texas, my state, but right now there's no way for Texas folks to know what Nebraska folks are doing to this area, and this amendment would encourage cross-pollination of ideas. I think it's a good idea, and I urge its passage. Thank you, and I appreciate the chair.
I thank the gentleman from Texas, and he's spoken eloquently on this issue before, and drought is obviously of concern to his state, as it is to the gentleman from Nebraska. Again, I would support their amendment, urge passage. If there's no further amendment, the vote occurs on the amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment is agreed to. The Ninth Amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Ehlers. We'll move to the Tenth Amendment on the roster, an amendment offered by the gentleman from California, Mr. Bilbray. Are you ready, Mr. Bilbray, to proceed with your amendment?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 009, offered by Mr. Bilbray of California.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading. Without objection, so ordered. Recognize the gentleman from California for 5 minutes to explain his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, this is very simple. It's the fact that it really, we want to make sure that the climate observation does not fall through the cracks as we're moving ahead with this. One of the critical components is that the observation capabilities are essential in not only knowing what may happen in the future, but what is already happening, what's working and not working. All this does is really emphasize that the observation aspect of the science must be maintained. We don't want to allow the process to shift over to the modeling and the analytical without maintaining the observation, because without updated observation, all of the computers in the world, all the great minds of the world, aren't going to be able to give us the results we need to do it. I just try to really nip it right back, just clarify. The scientists are saying that we've got to always keep the observation first and foremost and not go light on that when we're implementing our program. So it's basically all the amendment says.
I thank the gentleman. Are there any members wishing to comment?
Chairman.
Gentleman from Texas.
Yeah, NOAA is in the best position to be the lead agency in any interagency national climate service effort. And since NOAA would be setting up its climate service progress first, the structure of the interagency national climate service would be influenced by NOAA's actions, and this amendment would make sure that NOAA would take into account concerns and ideas from other federal agencies when setting up their own structure. I urge you to support this amendment. Yield back.
Mr. Bilbray, help me understand exactly. Say again, I'm in reading your amendment, I'm trying to make sure I understand what your intent is and how that's reflected in the language. Can you explain it again to us? I'm sorry.
The major concern that my scientists had, Mr. Chairman, was that it looked like that the the observation of climate and the monitoring of climate was not being given a guarantee that that was part of the process of being maintained down the line. It could be sort of backfilled by trying to do things with modeling and a lot of other. It's just sort of general. But the observation component, all I'm asking is that we include the wording to sort of guarantee that component is an essential part and won't be shortchanged down the line as this process evolves. You know, the base, I'll give you an example. Over the past decade, we've tried to work off of basic baselines of climate observations. If we don't, continue those observations and give priority to those observations, everything else we do downstream is going to be suspect. And all I'm asking with this amendment is that we make a commitment that that priority of observation will not be abandoned somewhere down the stream as we go over this, that all the stakeholders need to function from first the observation, and then we'll build off of that down the line.
If I may, I think you raise good points, and I think the first part of your amendment, as I read it, speaks to the issues you just raised. The second part, as we look at the text of the underlying bill, the second part, part two of which is on line eight, says all member agencies of the Committee on Environment and Natural Resources. Our understanding of the underlying bill is that that is referring to the NOAA report. And you're asking basically the structure of the bill already has an overarching agency, OSTP, and then the other agencies working together. But you're now mandating that NOAA, in its own portion of it, reach out to these other agencies when that will be part. So what I would ask, Mr. Bilbray, is I think we're favorably disposed to the first portion of this, the first paragraph, which gets at your key element here. And we don't necessarily have to do this here. I think we could add this as a manager's amendment before this comes to the floor. The first part, the second part, I think actually gives a somewhat contradictory message to NOAA. So I would personally suggest that we work with the gentleman to include something very, maybe the exact language in the first, lines one, two, and three, and then not battle it out over lines 8, 9, and 10. Would the gentleman be amenable
Mr.
to that?
Chairman, you yield.
Yes, I'd be happy to.
If the gentleman doesn't agree to that, do you plan to oppose the amendment?
I do indeed, because I think that the...
Well, that's a persuasive argument, Mr. Chairman. I'll agree to cooperate with you.
Great. I thank the gentleman. We'll work with you on that. Thank you. With that, are there other comments? Does the gentleman wish to withdraw the amendment then?
Yes, at this time I withdraw my amendment.
I thank the gentleman, and we will indeed work to try to incorporate the language. Mr. Ehlers was absent before. I would ask unanimous consent that we go back and take up the amendment that he had that we had addressed earlier. Hearing no objection, let me find that point in the. Does a member have Mr. Ehlers? You have an amendment.
somewhere here.
I'm in the same boat.
I thank you for the motion. I apologize.
Can the clerk find Mr. Ehlers' amendment and read it back to us? And
yes.
Okay, my amendment is at the desk.
It's amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 144 offered by Mr. Ehlers of Michigan.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So ordered. I recognize the gentleman from Michigan for 5 minutes to explain his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I apologize for being absent. I can get an excuse from the doctor's office if you like. The entire purpose of this amendment is to ensure that requiring the undersecretary shall ensure that the core functions and missions of the National Weather Service, the National Integrated Drought Information System, and any other programs within the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration are not diminished or neglected by establishment of the Climate Service Program or the duties imposed on such offices or programs under the subsection. This is just, it's becoming a constant refrain. I'm sure you recognize by now the points I've made earlier. I want to make sure the lines of authority are clearly established. I want to make sure that the NOAA and the National Weather Service or their other programs are not diminished by the addition of the Office of Science, but rather are enhanced by passing this bill. So I think it's straightforward, and I urge its adoption.
I appreciate the gentleman's comments. I've recognized myself briefly. I think the gentleman's comments are points are well taken. As I understand it, you're basically saying, look, as we work to establish the climate service, let's not vitiate the existing services of the various agencies you mentioned. That makes good sense, and hence I would urge passage of the amendment as well. Are there any other members wishing to offer comments on this amendment?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Hall, gentlemen.
I still want to get reliable weather information when I get up early in the morning. This amendment makes it sure that I'm going to do so. I urge the passage.
Well, it makes sure you get the information, whether it's reliable or not. So.
Well, Mr. Ranking Member, perhaps you should get up later.
Mr. Hall is an early riser. I can vouch for that. And when we were in Iraq together, he was running at what was it, 5 a.m., Mr. Hall?
Pretty early, yeah. I almost got shot.
I'm not making that up. We got up to see if we could wake up the gentleman from Texas. He said, oh, no, I've already been for a run, which meant running back and forth with his flak jacket on. He put the Marines to shame. So put us to shame. The Marines look pretty good.
You know, I'm not in a lot of times by the time news is on.
He's still out carousing. With that, the motion occurs on the amendment. All those in favor will signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment is adopted. The 11th amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Grayson. Mr. Grayson, are you ready to proceed with your amendment?
Yes, I have an amendment at the desk.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 018, offered by Mr. Grayson of Florida.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading. Without objection, so order. I recognize the gentleman from Florida for 5 minutes to explain his amendment.
Mr. Chairman, I concur with the research and science that shows a direct connection between global climate change and global weather changes. By establishing a national climate service at the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, we have the ability to gain a more complete understanding of the effects that climate change will have on weather patterns, natural resources, economic sectors, and our communities. I come from a community and a state that is no stranger to frequently changing, increasingly intense, and unpredictable weather patterns. Florida, with its 1,200 miles of coastline, has been the most vulnerable state in the country in regard to hurricane and tropical storm activity, with nearly double that of any other state in the total number of hurricanes and major storms on record since 1851. Some scientists are finding that global warming may not only create more extreme storms worldwide, but increase their intensity as well. Rising ocean temperatures are thought to be the main cause of the observed shift. It is calculated that a 1 degree increase in sea surface temperatures would result in a 31% increase in the global frequency of Category 4 and Category 5 storms per year, from 13 of those storms to 17. Basically, the oceans are getting warmer and hurricanes are getting more frequent and more intense as a result. Mr. Chairman, my amendment serves to increase research funding and capacity for scientists and regional weather forecasters to study global climate change's impact on weather changes. Specifically, my amendment would require the Undersecretary of NOAA to establish at least one regional integrated science and assessment team dedicated to applied regional climate research in the field of hurricane prediction, including probability modeling for landfall intensity and location, lightning, surge inundation, winds, rainfall, and flooding. Although I plan on withdrawing this amendment, I do ask the Chairman to enter into a colloquy with me regarding this important topic. Mr. Chairman, the increase in hurricanes, tropical storms, and other natural disasters remains my priority and a priority to my constituents. I'd like to work with you, Ranking Member Hall, and the committee staff to ensure that the views on this legislation reflect increased needs in research and funding for climate-weather connections. Additionally, as this bill moves to the House floor, I'd like to work with all my colleagues, particularly my colleagues from Florida and other hurricane-impacted states, to include similar language on this issue in the final legislative package. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back the balance of my time and withdraw my amendment.
I thank the gentleman and would offer the Chair's commitment to work precisely on this. I know this is an issue for yourself, Mr. Diaz-Balart, and others. In a manner comparable to Mr. Smith's concern about drought in his state, this is, again, precisely why we believe a climate service can be relevant. The exact proposal mechanism for that in the gentleman's language we think could be improved upon to better serve the needs he's addressing, and so I appreciate him withdrawing his amendment, but make a commitment, strong commitment, to work with him to make sure those concerns about hurricane forecasting and prediction are improved as part of the climate service when we draft the final legislation. I thank the gentleman for offering his amendment and appreciating the need to withdraw for improvement of the wording.
Thank you.
The 12th amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Olson. Are you ready to proceed with your amendment?
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment at the desk, and I ask for its immediate consideration.
The clerk will report the amendment, please.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 146, offered by Mr. Olson of Texas.
Ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading. Without objection, so ordered. I recognize the gentleman from Texas for 5 minutes to explain the amendment.
Mr. Chairman, thank you for the opportunity to offer this amendment. The success of this venture, in my mind, rests on the strength and reliability of the network that needs to be created to report to the National Climate Service. We currently do not have such a network, and there are challenges in how one would be created which is capable and efficient to achieve our stated goals. Providing reliable weather and climate information to the public requires expensive observing systems, long-term monitoring, and synthesis of collected data. My amendment would require an understanding of what technology is needed for such a network, what technology is available to us now, and what our strategy would be for implementing such a network. Problems in recent years with two satellite programs that were supposed to provide weather and climate data for the next two decades have threatened to cause gaps in the climate record. The quality of such products and service may be called into question if they are based on data and observations collected from declining and intermittent ground and satellite monitoring and observation systems. Also, when creating a new government program, which I hesitate to do through this legislation, it is worthwhile to understand the cost and timeliness of these efforts. As such, requiring cost implements and timelines would be beneficial to the committee to be able to judge how these efforts are progressing and if they are doing so in a responsible and beneficial way. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I urge the adoption of my amendment, and I yield back the balance of my time.
I appreciate the gentleman's comments. Would recognize myself for 5 minutes. The gentleman rightly has recognized the topic which has come up before in this hearing and many times before in this committee. Mr. Ehlers and others have spoken about NPOs and GOES. And the committee is already, I think, dedicated to trying to make progress in that, and I think progress is at long last being made. So there is, I think, strong and general support on the committee for having a strong observational infrastructure. The question that I'm asking myself is, to what extent is that appropriate for the climate service per se, given that you've already got NOAA and DOE and others working on these satellites? And so I think the gentleman's point is well taken, that we're going to need that infrastructure. I don't think it is the intent at this point to mandate that the climate service get into the business at the early point of prescribing new infrastructure. And so I'm a little worried about that. As initially conceptualized, I think it is to utilize the existing resources of the existing agencies. It may well be at some point, the gentleman may be correct. And so I'm reluctant. I would be reluctant personally to endorse this, lest we be opening up a whole new branch of authority for the climate service. And so with some reluctance, I'm inclined to oppose, but I think we ought to discuss the issue further about to what extent, and I think that discussion about to what extent infrastructure will be a part of the climate service portfolio would be best carried out as part of the discussion and planning. So, but gentlemen wish to respond to that?
Well, yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to respond to that. I mean, again, I think it's critically important as we go forward here with these new technologies that we make sure they work, that we make sure the taxpayers' dollars are spent efficiently, and we get the data that we demand and expect. And so I appreciate your comments. I look forward to working with you, but I do think this amendment is a step forward.
Yeah, it's certainly well-intentioned, and I think it relates back also to the earlier issues about a NOAA Organic Act, and invite the gentleman to, and I know he has been involved with the whole issue of making sure these NPOs and other satellites work. So are there others who wish to comment on this amendment? My inclination, again, will be to oppose the amendment, but not the spirit of the amendment, and I want to just make sure we think carefully about whether we want to add to the portfolio an infrastructure component. We may, but I think it may want more. Mr. Ehlers, did you wish to comment?
Just on behalf of Mr. Hall, who had to step out, and he made a comment that this amendment is similar to what Mr. Bilbrey tried to do for the interagency report, would require NOAA to identify existing technology for observations and monitoring and develop a strategy for future plans. Would also require a cost accounting of the strategy and a timeline in which it should be implemented to prevent any gaps in the climate record. Considering the importance of observations and monitoring as the basis of these climate services and products, this amendment would ensure that such systems are being planned for and budgeted for. I urge all my colleagues to support this amendment, and I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. Are there others wishing to offer comment or suggestion? Hearing none, the vote occurs on the amendment. All those in favor will signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. No. The opinion of the chair, the noes have it. Motion is not, or amendment is not agreed to. The 13th Amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Diaz-Balart. Mr. Diaz-Balart, are you ready?
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, Amendment Number 145, offered by Mr. Mario Diaz-Balart of Florida.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So ordered, I recognize the gentleman from Florida for 5 minutes to explain his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I won't take all that time. This amendment is about as simple and as straightforward as it gets. I will read the entire thing, and actually, on page 19, after line 7, it just inserts one sentence. It says, provide a detailed accounting of the cost of implementation and maintenance of such climate service program. I don't think this is a controversial, it shouldn't be a controversial amendment, Mr. Chairman. It just basically says that they should tell us how much it's going to cost this program's going to cost. That's it. That's all it does, nothing else. And again, so very simple, very straightforward, and I think very clearly written. And that's the explanation, Mr. Chairman.
I appreciate the gentleman's comments. Essentially, this is already going to be required. If there is to be a service created, they'll have to have a budget. The budget will become before the Congress. So I concur entirely with the gentleman's intent. I think it's somewhat superfluous because we already have provisions that you have to, they'll have to offer a budget and the Congress will have to fund it. The gentleman's recognized.
Mr. Chairman, my understanding is that this is just a NOAA and not for the interagency and that it does not, it's not provided there. So it is a little different, and that's why I think it does apply here. And again, you're right. It pretty much goes along with the spirit of the bill. It's just that in this particular area it doesn't have it. So again, it's very simple. It shouldn't be controversial.
Is the gentleman's concern that NOAA would somehow be exempted from dealing with this in the budget, in NOAA's budget?
Again, Mr. Chairman, my concern is just this, that I want to make sure that, including in this part, that we have access to information. That's it. In other words, it's not trying to complicate things. It just tries to say, you're right, that obviously we all want to know how much it costs. Mm-hmm. I just want to clarify that even in this area, that we should just know how much it costs. Again, it's not trying to derail anything. It's not trying to...
Yeah, I take
right.
It
so I want to make sure that my intention is not to do anything negative other just to give Congress the information that we should have, obviously.
Mr. Ehlers?
Mr. Chairman, just to clarify, I don't think the gentleman is asking for additional budget information. This would just be part of the implementation plan that is developed, and I would expect we would all want that information as they are developing their plan, what they estimate the total cost of the implementation will be. And help us as a committee make a judgment about whether to proceed.
I thank the gentleman. The legislation as it's currently written already requires that NOAA and other agencies would have to detail personnel and other resources required. So in effect, it's already, maybe I'm not trying to quibble with you. I think the gentleman's point is well taken. Before we create government programs, we ought to ask what they're going to cost. That's common sense. The question for me is, to what extent are we being superfluous with this, and by sort of singling NOAA out, are we then going to say, well, we didn't do it to the various other agencies, because ultimately the ultimate climate service will draw upon multiple agencies. And so what I sort of, it's a well-intentioned but likely unnecessary amendment is what I would argue with it. And therefore, I'll urge a no vote, but not because of the idea or intention is not worthy. It's just I think it's already taken care of. Mr. Ehlers?
Just a comment, if we were to oppose unnecessary amendments, there would be very few amendments around this building.
And it would be a happier place for one and all.
I urge adoption.
I thank the gentleman. Mr. Diaz-Balart, did you have a final comment?
Yes, brief, Mr. Chairman. I don't want to beat a dead horse, so to speak. But again, I think we need to make sure that before it takes place that we have the information as opposed to after. And that's what this would do. In other words, that's what this attempts to do. Count votes, but I, regardless of what happens now, I don't think this, that's the issue. I don't think this does any harm.
Yeah.
And I think it's better to be doubly cautious to make sure that we have the information as opposed to err on the other side. If we're going to err on one side, we should err on the side of information, not lack of information. That's why I don't, Mr. Chairman, again, this is half empty, half full. I don't think this hurts. So therefore, my humble recommendation would be to accept it, and then we'll work through it and make sure that it doesn't create any problems, which is not my intention, as opposed to err on the other side. And that's all.
What I would suggest we do is see if we'll go ahead and call the vote. But what I would suggest we'll do is try to work with the gentleman and see if we can get some more broad language, covering all the various agencies and talking about costs, maybe being a little more specific about getting cost estimates for all the agencies rather than singling NOAA out versus USGS or NRCS, whatever. So the intent of getting the most accurate estimates of cost is heartily agreed to by the chair. So we'll call the vote. I would urge a no vote. I would plan to hope we can work with the gentleman to maybe add some more specific cost information.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
With that, the vote occurs on the amendment. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed signify by saying no. No.
And, Mr. Chairman, could we just call the roll vote? Never mind. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your kindness.
Roll call vote's been requested. The clerk will call the roll.
Chairman Gordon. Mr. Costello. Ms. Johnson, Ms. Woolsey, Mr. Wu, Mr. Baird,
no.
Mr. Baird votes no, Mr. Miller votes no, Mr. Lipinski,
no.
Mr. Lipinski votes no, Ms. Giffords, Ms. Giffords votes no, Ms. Edwards votes no, Ms. Fudge votes no, Mr. Lujan votes no, Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes no. Mr. Griffith?
No.
Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Rothman? Mr. Matheson? Mr. Davis? Mr. Chandler?
No.
Mr. Chandler votes no. Mr. Carnahan? Mr. Hill?
No.
Mr. Hill votes no. Mr. Mitchell?
Aye.
Mr. Mitchell votes aye. Mr. Wilson? Mrs. Dahlkemper.
Aye.
Ms. Dahlkemper votes aye. Mr. Grayson. Ms. Comas. Ms. Comas votes aye. Mr. Peters. Mr. Hall.
Aye.
Mr. Hall votes aye. Mr. Sensenbrenner. Mr. Lamar Smith. Mr. Roybacher. Mr. Bartlett. Mr. Ehlers.
Aye.
Mr. Ehlers votes aye. Mr. Lucas. Mrs. Biggert.
Aye.
Mrs. Biggert votes aye. Mr. Aiken.
Yes.
Mr. Aiken votes aye. Mr. Nagebauer. Mr. Inglis.
Aye.
Mr. Inglis votes aye. Mr. McCall.
Aye.
Mr. McCall votes aye. Mr. Diaz-Balart.
Aye.
Mr. Diaz-Balart votes aye. Mr. Bilbray. Mr. Adrian Smith. Mr. Adrian Smith votes aye. Mr. Brown. Mr. Olson.
Aye.
Mr. Olson votes aye.
Are there any other members who wish to record the vote? Mr. Rothman?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to record
no. Mr. Rothman votes no.
Mr. Rohrbacher?
Votes yes.
Mr. Rohrbacher, yes. Any other members who wish to be recorded or wish to change your vote? Mr. Wu. Would the gentleman like to support or oppose the amendment?
I would like to oppose the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Wu. Thank you for joining us. Mr. Wu votes no. Any other? Mr. Matheson? Are there any other members? Hearing none, I'd ask the clerk to tally the votes.
Mr. Chairman, 13 members vote aye and 14 members vote no.
The amendment is not adopted. I would just underscore that, in my judgment, is not a vote against responsible cost estimate. It's the language that we'll use to do that. I commit, reiterate my personal commitment to work with the gentleman to be more specific about broad estimates of cost for all the agencies involved, but with more carefully crafted language. So the intent of the amendment is well taken. The language is what was at issue there.
And Mr.
Chairman, would the clerk repeat the tally? I understand there are some questions. Would the clerk retally the votes? Thank you for checking the record. Please state again what the...
Yes, Mr. Chairman, 13 members vote aye and 14 members vote no.
Again, the amendment does not pass, but...
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Hall.
Can the record reflect it? We're gaining on you.
The record can so reflect that we're gaining us. What was it Satchel Paige said?
Said, don't look back, he may be gaining.
I think that's what Mr. Paige said. The 14th Amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from South Carolina. Mr. Inglis, are you ready to proceed with your amendment, Mr. Inglis? The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, offered by Mr. Inglis of South Carolina, amendment number 004.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So ordered. Recognize the gentleman from 5 minutes to explain the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This amendment before us will ensure that NOAA properly considers the needs and capabilities of its stakeholder groups and interagency partners while developing an operational climate service program. As I said in the Energy and Environment Subcommittee markup last month, on its own, NOAA does not have the capacity or the resources to meet the broad needs of the climate information user community. This amendment ensures that NOAA will consult with other federal agencies, state climate offices, and regional climate centers as it determines what role it will play in as a climate product and service provider, and will cause NOAA to define its climate service role in the national effort. I urge this committee to support passage of the amendment, Mr. Chairman, and would yield back the balance of my time.
I thank the gentleman. I think his amendment is well-crafted and well-intended, and I am inclined to support it personally. Are there other members wishing to speak to the amendment? Hearing none, the motion, I'm sorry, Mr. Lujan.
Mr. Chairman, just a clarification. I know that the language already includes stakeholders. Is this intended to include and spell out all stakeholders as opposed to just the few offices that have been included?
If the gentleman would yield, our attempt here is to make sure that NOAA is consulting with all relevant federal authorities or agencies, especially the state climate offices and regional climate centers. Those are that's what we're mostly after.
So in other words, it's not excluding other agencies, but you're right. Particularly focusing on those. That's my understanding of it.
Right.
It's an excellent point for clarification.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions about the amendment? If no, the vote occurs on the amendment. All those in favor will signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment is adopted. The 15th amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentlelady from Texas, Ms. Eddie Bernice Johnson. Ms. Johnson, are you ready to proceed? The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 051, offered by Ms. Eddie Bernice Johnson of Texas.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So ordered. Recognize the gentlelady for 5 minutes to explain the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member. My amendment directs the Undersecretary to establish a Summer Institutes program within the regional climate centers. The program for middle and high school teachers and also for undergraduate students would include a 2-week summer learning institute at the regional, climate centers. This would allow teachers throughout the country to come or go to the regional climate centers to interact with scientists and develop curriculum and direction. This enrichment experience can help teachers bring the excitement of science back into the classroom. Their students might otherwise never be exposed to this type of research. They will have the opportunity to learn how we study the climate and weather. They can see that a career in climate science is accessible and desirable. The seed must be planted early. Studies have found that especially minority students began to underachieve in math and science as early as the fifth grade. In addition, my amendment would also allow for undergraduate students to come to the regional climate centers. Exposure to climate scientists and their work may inspire them to further their studies in the field. This committee has held hearings on the importance of informal, hands-on learning settings that are outside the classroom. And there is no question that experience-based learning is very important, especially for science education. Scientific inquiry comes alive and is best taught in a research environment. allowing teachers and students to come to the regional climate centers to learn the scientific method will help invigorate tomorrow's generation of climate scientists. The Summer Institutes program authorized by my amendment is similar to a program at the Department of Energy that was passed in the America Competes. And all of us know that for the last 15 or 16 years that I've been on this committee, we've talked about making sure that our teachers are well prepared to teach in the STEM areas. No specific funds are designated for this program. My amendment simply authorizes the program at the discretion of the Undersecretary. When we provide educational opportunities for our young people, we ensure that we have a new generation of competitive scientists who are trained here in the U.S., who are prepared to excel in climate science. Thank you for considering this amendment, and I'd urge support. Yield back the balance of my time.
I thank the gentlelady. The gentlelady has, as we all know, a long and a distinguished record of advocating education, particularly for minorities and women, and she continues that commitment with this amendment, which I think is very constructive and well-intended and drafted. I would urge a yes vote. Are there other members who wish to comment on it? Mr. Aiken.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think I maybe just have a question and possibly an amendment, but just kind of depends on the answer to the question. My understanding is that what you're trying to do, and I'm a huge fan of the sort of hands-on. I think that in a lot of our schools, science is kind of undertaught, and so I'm very supportive of what you're trying to accomplish. And my understanding is that what this is doing is in this summer program, you're putting together and defining what it is that the people are going to be doing there, what's going to be taught, et cetera, et cetera. My concern was that I could read this in two different ways. And one is if we're mandating some kind of curriculum, which kind of makes me a little nervous, if the curriculum that you're talking about doing specifically, I get on the, I don't know if your page number's same as mine, but particularly on page 2, eligible middle school and high school teachers to integrate weather and climate sciences into their curricula. Is this designed just to define what's going to happen at this summer institute, or are you really trying to define a curricula that's going to go into classrooms?
With the gentleman yield.
Yeah, I do yield.
In 2 weeks, you really can't write a curriculum. But you can pick up ideas and network with other teachers in order to enhance your own skills. And that's all the intent is here.
Right. If that's the case, then I don't have any, I think it's a good amendment. There's no way this could be read, Mr. Chairman, to be dictating any curriculum beyond just what's being done in this summer thing. Is that correct? Would that be your understanding as well?
That's my understanding as well. I think that's the gentlelady's intent.
That's my intent.
Well, thank you. I would yield back. I had an amendment, but I don't think it's necessary at this point.
I thank the gentleman for the clarification. Dr. Ehlers.
Just a comment. I'm not positive of this, but I'd appreciate it if it could be checked out. I think the National Science Foundation already offers a program like this, and obviously has a lot of expertise in the education field, a lot of contacts, and so forth. And so my request is that the staff check this out. And if the National Science Foundation is involved, I would think the best thing would be to take advantage of both of them and have them develop a cooperative program between the science centers, whatever they are, and the National Science Foundation, so we take advantage of the knowledge of both.
Could the gentleman yield?
Yes, I'd be happy to yield.
There is a similar program in America Competes that we struggled with several years.
Right.
And the Department of Energy has a similar one. I have no problem with them being consolidated or coordinated. It's just that I thought this was an opportunity to broaden the teacher's knowledge. Mm-hmm. And the students, and give them a better orientation so that perhaps they can get interested in staying in the sciences.
Reclaiming my time, may I just suggest that before this goes to the floor, perhaps as part of the manager's amendment, that we develop, make the comment that we would hope these would work together somehow. Because I think we have a lot of good experience already in NSF, and I'm sure these centers could, certainly at least for the first several years, could benefit from that because they probably don't have a lot of experience in education. With that, I'll yield back.
Dr. Ehlers, that's a point well taken, and as I acknowledged Eddie Bernice Johnson's commitment to education, yours is equally strong and long, and we very much appreciate the suggestion. I think it's well taken and would certainly support incorporating that. If there are no further comments.
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, Mr. Hall.
Yeah, I'd like to strike the last word.
You're recognized.
I appreciate what Ms. Johnson is trying to do with the amendment and certainly recognize the benefits of summer institutions. I had agreed with Mr. Akins that it's not a federal responsibility to develop curricula, but I was going to vote with Mrs. Johnson whether she took Mr. Akins' amendment or not, and I still am. I just suggest that that my dear friend, Ms. Johnson, stay willing to work to address this and work with Mr. Akins, see if anything can be worked out. But I have a hard time leaving Eddie Bernice Johnson on almost anything she recommends. I yield back.
I thank the gentleman for his comments and appreciate the gentlelady's commitment to work with her colleagues. If there are no further comments, the vote occurs on the amendment. All in favor will signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment is agreed to. The 16th amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentlelady from Ohio, Ms. Fudge. Are you ready to proceed with your amendment?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment at the desk.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 018, offered by Ms. Fudge of Ohio.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So ordered. I recognize the gentlelady for 5 minutes to explain the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a very simple and straightforward amendment. This amendment would direct NOAA's administration to establish and maintain an information clearinghouse for the collection and distribution of information. This will assist in keeping states, local and tribal governments, and the general public informed about the resources and information that are available. The clearinghouse will also include a website domain that would serve as a user-friendly resource with links to all relevant climate activities, resources, and information. This amendment supports one of the most important goals of the National Climate Service, which is to expand the delivery of climate services by the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration and other relevant federal agencies. I believe a clearinghouse will provide widespread access to valuable information to outside organizations that otherwise may not be afforded exposure to these important resources. Ultimately, a clearinghouse improves the National Climate Service by creating a central location where users and stakeholders can access the information they need. With that, Mr. Chairman, I thank you and I'd urge my colleagues to support the amendment and I yield back.
I thank the gentlelady. It's always nice when comments suggested hearings are actually taken up by members who pay attention and respond. Certainly this was an issue raised by some of our witnesses, the fact that many people either didn't know there were services that could be beneficial to them or knew that they had a need but didn't know where to get those services. And I think your amendment admirably addresses both of those concerns, and I fully endorse it and support it. Are there other members wishing to offer comments? Hearing none, the vote occurs on the amendment. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment is agreed to. The 17th amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Olson. Are you ready to proceed with your amendment, Mr. Olson?
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment at the desk and ask for its immediate consideration.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 004, offered by Mr. Olson of Texas.
Ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So ordered. Recognize the gentleman for 5 minutes to explain his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I've observed throughout the debate on the creation of this type of agency, there's no consensus among policymakers, academics, researchers, or bureaucrats about how a National Climate Service should be structured. NOAA has been having ongoing internal discussions since the previous administration about how to set up a National Climate Service. NOAA is considered by many to be the natural lead for such a program due to their current focus on climate research and their experience in providing information and data products through the National Weather Service. The lack of agreement was illustrated right here in this room at the May 5, 2009 subcommittee hearing on developing a National Climate Service. The NOAA administrator, Dr. Lubchenco, stated that an NCS should be an interagency effort with OSTP taking up a significant leadership role. and Dr. Eric Barron, the director of the National Center for Atmospheric Research and a member of NOAA's Scientific Advisory Board, chaired the development of an SAB report that offered four different alternative structures for an NCS, including expanding the National Weather Service to a National Weather and Climate Service, creating a new line office in NOAA, creating an interagency group, much like the Climate Change Science Program, and finally, creating a nonprofit federated organization. Dr. Philip Moat, director of the Oregon Regional Integrated Sciences and Assessment Team, emphasized the need to expand regional resources and refocus services at the regional and local levels. Since H.R. 2407 doesn't limit the structure of a future National Climate Service and delegates significant authority to NOAA with little or no recourse for disagreement, a sunset provision would provide Congress an opportunity to revisit this issue and determine if the chosen structure of the service at that time is effective, efficient, and appropriate. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I urge adoption of my amendment, and I yield back my time.
I thank the gentleman, and I appreciate his attention to comments from the hearing. Congress doesn't necessarily need a sunset provision to review this program. The gentleman's points are well taken that there have been other models offered, and legislation before us doesn't necessarily prejudice the outcome. I think there was general sense of agreement about some of the broad structure of what a climate service should look like. We will have an opportunity to review the recommendations of OSTP and the various agencies before the climate service is actually created. So hopefully we'll get it right the first time. If we don't, there's nothing requiring us, or rather prohibiting us, from revisiting the issue down the road. Hence, while the gentleman's amendment is well intended, I'm inclined to oppose it because we have that opportunity to revisit this at some point in the future and make modifications as needed. I think there, the prospect of a major service like this abruptly terminating can create significant problems for agencies as they look at their budget, as people try to make commitments to sign on to work for the agencies, et cetera. So I appreciate the gentleman's comments. I would urge a no vote. Are there others who would like to offer comments or questions? Hearing none, the vote occurs. On
Mr.
The
Chairman, one last question. Please. I mean, and I appreciate your comments. I think the one big difference is my amendment would give this committee, this Congress, an opportunity to weigh in before some problems developed and we got too far down the road. And that's why I urge adoption of my amendment. And to get forward, I'll ask for a recorded vote as well.
I appreciate the gentleman's comment, and so noted. The vote occurs on the amendment. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. No. The nays have it. The amendment is not agreed to, but a recorded vote has been requested. The clerk will call the roll, please.
Chairman Gordon. Mr. Costello. Ms. Johnson. Ms. Johnson votes no. Ms. Woolsey. Mr. Wu. Mr. Baird.
No.
Mr. Baird votes no. Mr. Miller.
No.
Mr. Miller votes no. Mr. Lipinski.
No.
Mr. Lipinski votes no. Ms. Giffords.
No.
Ms. Giffords votes no. Ms. Edwards.
No.
Ms. Edwards votes no. Ms. Fudge.
No.
Ms. Fudge votes no. Mr. Lujan.
No.
Mr. Lujan votes no. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes no. Mr. Griffith.
No.
Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Rothman.
No.
Mr. Rothman votes no. Mr. Matheson. Mr. Matheson votes no. Mr. Davis. Mr. Chandler.
No.
Mr. Chandler votes no. Mr. Carnahan.
No.
Mr. Carnahan votes no. Mr. Hill.
No.
Mr. Hill votes no. Mr. Mitchell.
No.
Mr. Mitchell votes no. Mr. Wilson. Mrs. Dahlkemper.
No.
Mrs. Dahlkemper votes no. Mr. Grayson.
No.
Mr. Grayson votes no. Mrs. Cosmos.
No.
Mrs. Cosmos votes no. Mr. Peters. Mr. Hall.
Yes.
Mr. Hall votes aye. Mr. Sensenbrenner. Mr. Lamar Smith. Mr. Roybacher.
Yes.
Mr. Roybacher votes aye. Mr. Bartlett. Mr. Ehlers. Mr. Ehlers votes aye. Mr. Lucas? Mrs. Biggert?
Aye.
Mrs. Biggert votes aye. Mr. Aiken?
Aye.
Mr. Aiken votes aye. Mr. Nagebauer? Mr. Inglis?
Aye.
Mr. Inglis votes aye. Mr. McCall?
Aye.
Mr. McCall votes aye. Mr. Diaz-Balart?
Aye.
Mr. Diaz-Balart votes aye. Mr. Bilbray? Mr. Adrian Smith?
Aye.
Mr. Adrian Smith votes aye. Mr. Brown? Mr. Olson? Mr. Olson votes aye.
Are there any other members who wish to have their vote recorded? Mr. Brown has asked for an aye vote. Any other members? Mr. Bartlett?
Aye.
Any other members? I don't want to miss anyone. The clerk will tally the votes, please.
Mr. Chairman, 12 members vote aye and 19 members vote no.
The amendment is not agreed to. The 18th amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from California, Mr. Rohrbacher. Are you ready to proceed with your amendment, Mr. Rohrbacher?
I have an amendment.
Clerk will report the amendment, please.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 015, offered by Mr. Rohrbacher of California.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading. Without objection, so ordered. I recognize the gentleman from California for 5 minutes to explain the
This amendment is a clear and simple amendment, but let me note that what this amendment is based upon, it is a report that has been issued by the Heartland Institute, which paid for this, but the actual author is Anthony Watt, who conducted a scientific investigation in cooperation with Dr. Richard Pielke, who is the head of the science department at the Colorado State University. And they went out to take a look at all of the monitoring stations on which our climate decisions have been made, and a lot of the predictions that we've that we've heard about over the last few years have been based on temperatures that have been recorded at these various climate monitoring stations throughout the United States. Every one of them were checked by the people who went out to conduct this research, and they found that 70% of all of the climate and monitoring stations that were in use and that we rely upon for this information that all of this debate is predicated on, 70% of the monitoring stations were flawed or compromised. Many of them were placed so close to air conditioning units of buildings that, as you know, an air conditioning unit spits out hot air on one side as it's cooling the inside of a building. They found that large numbers of these monitoring stations were giving us faulty information. And I would submit that, at this point, Mr. Chairman, I would submit this report for the record in this debate. Mr. Chairman, I would submit this report for the record. This
point. Without objection, so ordered.
All right. What my amendment simply does is to suggest that the National Academy of Science must independently certify that the regional, state, and local infrastructure, meaning these monitoring stations, can provide good data before we launch a climate service that will be dependent upon these very pieces of technology and as sources of information. So I don't find, considering the fact that we now have on the record a report that's calling into question the viability of this infrastructure, we should be verifying it before we are actually launch a climate service that would be dependent on this source of information. That's what my amendment does, and I would ask my colleagues on both sides of the aisle to think of this as a realistic and I think a very rational way to move forward if we are serious about having a climate service. And we must make sure that climate service is based on real science, which is what we've all talked about, and that's what this would mandate. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
I appreciate the gentleman's comments. the point, I think, is well taken, that we should base our scientific decisions on valid and accurate measurements, and I would certainly encourage the various agencies to endeavor to do so to the greatest extent possible. At the same time, I think there's a concern about, as I read it, is a gentleman suggesting that the National Academy of Sciences would become a certifying body for instrumentation?
Yes, I would suggest that the National Academy of Sciences is a perfectly viable means for us to certify whether the scientific instrumentation that is being relied upon by this new service, climate service, is actually working accurately and reliably.
I appreciate the clarification. I believe that there are other bodies that are probably better suited to that role, and perhaps it would be appropriate to direct in general language that the climate service, once established, do to the greatest extent possible ensure the validity and accuracy of any instrumentation used in making its forecast. But I think placing that burden on the National Academies of Science is not really the proper entity or the role for the NAS. And so for that reason, while I appreciate the gentleman's commitment to valid measurement, I would oppose the amendment. Are there others wishing to offer comment or questions about the amendment? Hearing none, the motion, a vote occurs on the amendment. Those in favor will signify by saying aye. Those opposed, no. The noes have it.
Then I'd ask for a recorded vote.
A recorded vote has been requested. The clerk will please call the roll.
Chairman Gordon. Mr. Costello. Ms. Johnson. Ms. Johnson votes no. Ms. Woolsey. Mr. Wu. Mr. Baird.
No.
Mr. Baird votes no. Mr. Miller.
No.
Mr. Miller votes no. Mr. Lipinski.
No.
Mr. Lipinski votes no. Ms. Giffords. Ms. Giffords votes no. Ms. Edwards.
No.
Ms. Edwards votes no. Ms. Fudge.
No.
Ms. Fudge votes no. Mr. Lujan.
No.
Mr. Lujan votes no. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes no. Mr. Griffith.
No.
Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Rothman.
No.
Mr. Rothman votes no. Mr. Matheson.
No.
Mr. Matheson votes no. Mr. Davis.
No.
Mr. Davis votes no. Mr. Chandler.
No.
Mr. Chandler votes no. Mr. Carnahan.
No.
Mr. Carnahan votes no. Mr. Hill.
No.
Mr. Hill votes no. Mr. Mitchell.
No.
Mr. Mitchell votes no. Mr. Wilson. Mrs. Dahlkemper.
No.
Ms. Dahlkemper votes no. Mr. Grayson.
No.
Mr. Grayson votes no. Ms. Cosmas. Ms. Cosmas votes no. Mr. Peters. Mr. Hall.
He said aye.
Did he say aye? Mr. Hall?
Aye.
Okay. Mr. Hall votes aye. Mr. Sensenbrenner. Mr. Lamar Smith. Mr. Roybacher. Mr. Roy Barker votes aye. Mr. Bartlett.
Aye.
Mr. Bartlett votes aye. Mr. Ehlers.
Aye.
Mr. Ehlers votes aye. Mr. Lucas. Mrs. Biggert.
Aye.
Mrs. Biggert votes aye. Mr. Aiken.
Aye.
Mr. Aiken votes aye. Mr. Nagebauer. Mr. Inglis.
Aye.
Mr. Inglis votes aye. Mr. McCall.
Aye.
Mr. McCall votes aye. Mr. Diaz-Balart.
Aye.
Mr. Diaz-Balart votes aye. Mr. Bilbray. Mr. Adrian Smith.
Aye.
Mr. Adrian Smith votes aye. Mr. Brown.
Aye.
Mr. Brown votes aye. Mr. Olson.
Aye.
Mr. Olson votes aye.
Is any other member not recorded who wishes to vote? Court report the tally.
Mr. Chairman, 12 members vote aye and 20 members vote no.
Mr. Hall, the record will reflect that we're ganging on you. The 19th amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Texas. Mr. Hall, are you ready to proceed with your amendment?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment to the desk.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, Amendment Number 010, offered by...
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection, so ordered.
Mr. Chairman, I thank you. My amendment would ensure that the National Climate Service that's established in this bill would not be used to provide data and information for any regulatory regime until a national infrastructure of observing, monitoring, measuring, and verification technologies has been certified by the national academies as being able to provide accurate and verifiable information at the regional, state, or the local levels. Mr. Chairman, we're well aware of the suggestions, and we've discussed it here today, the likelihood or the possibility that they might include in this bill into the larger H.R. 2454, the Waxman-Markey bill, that it will probably be worked into that. And while on the surface it seems to make some sense, I have serious concerns about doing this. The National Climate Service created in our bill would most likely be expanded in its mission to include monitoring and measuring of greenhouse gas emissions for the purpose of implementing a cap and trade regime. Now, in the two hearings we held on monitoring, reporting, and verification technologies, our two hearings were held, I believe, in April or May, something like that, didn't reflect that there was any infrastructure existing now to perform such tasks as would be performed. The only industry sector that currently employs a continuous emissions monitoring system for carbon dioxide is the electric utility sector. However, this bill, the H.R. 2454, the Markey bill, intends to regulate far beyond this single industry, far beyond what the electric utility has set up. And until we have a national infrastructure of monitoring technologies in place, any baseline used as a starting point for a cap and trade regime is going to be generated through best guess estimates at its very best. Guessing is hardly a sound method for being a regulatory or basing a regulatory regime that stands to be the largest change in U.S. public policy since the New Deal. My amendment would protect all Americans from being subject to political estimates and ideological guesses, and I urge my colleagues to support it. I yield back.
Thank you. I now recognize myself for 5 minutes to speak in opposition. This is not a regulatory bill. I know there is a concern that perhaps some of the data collected or the analysis from the National Climate Service might at some point in the future be used to support efforts at regulation or regulatory procedures. That is not the purpose of the bill. This does give to the National Academy of Scientists a role that they have not asked for and almost certainly do not want. It is not in the nature of scientists to be certain about anything. Mr. Hall characterized scientists as just making their best guess. Scientists call that scientific method. They aren't ever sure. They come to the most likely explanation given the available data. When the data changes, they remain open to another explanation. That is what scientists do. So asking them to certify is asking them to do something that is not in their job description and is something they are, in fact, they are trained, they are educated not to do. So I urge the, in addition to the arguments that Mr. Baird offered with a very similar amendment that Mr. Rohrabacher offered just a moment ago, that specifically certification for measurements is not even National Academy isn't even the best agency to do that. Does any other, I yield back my time, does any other member wish to be heard?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Rohrabacher.
Yeah, just a few moments in support of the idea of trying to have some form of verification of the technologies that we are going to be depending on for this new service. Both mine and of course, Congressman Hall's amendments are aimed at trying to ensure the quality of what we are going to launch, a program we're launching. I think it's a bit flabbergasted. I'm a bit flabbergasted that this was even looked at as being controversial. I mean, it's the National Academy of Sciences, it says that they don't certify things. They are making determinations all the time. There's nothing wrong with that. I mean, we're asking their opinions. We're asking them to do work for us on large numbers of issues. They are scientists. And yes, they make decisions. And no, they are not people who just simply can't come to conclusions. They come to conclusions. They come to scientific conclusions. We are asking their advice on to making sure that the technology that is being put in place, the technological infrastructure, is adequate and is operating well enough to provide us with good data. What could be more common sense than that? I mean, we keep hearing over the years, good science, we got to do good science. Well, this is trying to ensure good science, but yet we have people calling on question of whether the National Academy of Science is qualified to determine what good science is. This is, I find it very perplexing, the arguments that are being used to oppose this, and I would have thought that there'd be a little bit more cooperation on reasonable amendments like the ones that we are discussing. And Mr. Hall's amendment, I think my amendment was reasonable as well, and I'm very disappointed that it's not being taken in the bipartisan spirit that it's being offered.
Any other member? Mr. Orbacher yields back.
Mr. Chairman,
yield back my time.
Ask Mr. Orbacher not to yield back his time.
I would yield
to me
Hall.
If you would. I'll be brief, Mr. Chairman. The way this amendment's constructed, the rest of the bill could go forward. It's just not regulated by any regime. And actually, I think you questioned it. It has happened before. The National Academy is capable of doing this type work. They did scientific assessment of high power free election and laser technology in 2009. They have a history of it, and there's no question that they can give us some sensible common sense protection that this amendment offers. And I yield back my time.
All right, any other member wish to be heard? Does Mr. Orbacher now yield back?
Yield back the balance of my time.
I don't think I've ever heard Mr. Orbacher say that before. Any other member wish to be heard? If not, we will proceed to the vote. On the amendment? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. The noes have it.
Mr. Chairman, I ask for a recorded.
Ask for a recorded vote, please.
All right. Clerk will call the roll.
Chairman Gordon. Mr. Costello. Ms. Johnson. Ms. Woolsey. Mr. Wu.
No.
Mr. Wu votes no. Mr. Baird. Mr. Miller.
No.
Mr. Miller votes no. Mr. Lipinski.
No.
Mr. Lipinski votes no. Ms. Giffords. Ms. Giffords votes no. Ms. Edwards. Ms. Fudge.
No.
Ms. Fudge votes no. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes no. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes no. Mr. Griffith.
No.
Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Rothman?
No.
Mr. Rothman votes no. Mr. Matheson? Mr. Matheson votes no. Mr. Davis?
No.
Mr. Davis votes no. Mr. Chandler? Mr. Chandler votes no. Mr. Carnahan?
No.
Mr. Carnahan votes no. Mr. Hill?
No.
Mr. Hill votes no. Mr. Mitchell?
No.
Mr. Mitchell votes no. Mr. Wilson? Mrs. Dahlkemper?
No.
Mrs. Dahlkemper votes no. Mr. Grayson?
No.
Mr. Grayson votes no. Mrs. Cosmas?
No.
Mrs. Cosmas votes no. Mr. Peters?
No.
Mr. Peters votes no. Mr. Hall?
Aye.
Mr. Hall votes aye. Mr. Sensenbrenner? Mr. Lamar Smith? Mr. Roybacher?
Yeah.
Mr. Roybacher votes aye. Mr. Bartlett?
Aye.
Mr. Bartlett votes aye. Mr. Ehlers?
Aye.
Mr. Ehlers votes aye. Mr. Lucas? Mrs. Biggert?
Aye.
Mrs. Biggert votes aye. Mr. Aiken? Mr. Aiken votes aye. Mr. Nagebauer. Mr. Inglis. Mr. Inglis votes aye. Mr. McCall. Mr. McCall votes aye. Mr. Diaz-Balart.
Aye.
Mr. Diaz-Balart votes aye. Mr. Bilbray. Mr. Adrian Smith. Mr. Adrian Smith votes aye. Mr. Brown?
Aye.
Mr. Brown votes aye. Mr. Olson?
Aye.
Mr. Olson votes aye.
Who else? Mr. Baird
no.
votes no.
Mr. Baird votes
Ms.
no.
Edwards?
Ms. Edwards votes
Ms.
no.
Ms. Woolsey?
No.
Ms. Woolsey votes no.
Any other member not recorded who wishes to be recorded? The clerk will tally the vote.
Mr. Chairman, 12 members vote aye and 22 members vote no.
The amendment is not agreed to. The 20th amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Neugebauer.
Chairman, I would ask unanimous consent to submit the amendment for Mr. Neugebauer.
Without objection. Mr. Warbacher is
I have an amendment to the desk.
Clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 010, offered by Mr. Neugebauer of Texas.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection, so ordered.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Mr.
I recognize the gentleman for 5 minutes to explain Mr. Neugebauer's amendment and his.
All right. Thank you very much. What this amendment is very similar to the two amendments that Mr. Hall and I have put forward today, but it basically suggests that we must make sure that any data that's collected from monitoring that is taking place in another country, that information and that monitoring be certified as being accurate and verifiable by the National Academy of Sciences. It's just, again, this is a suggestion that we have some kind of quality assurance that the information that we're basing our judgments on for this new service that we are creating today is accurate. I can see no reason why anyone who believes in real science would not want to ensure that the information that what is by the government organization that is being created by this act, that that information is accurate and is certified as accurate. This is especially important considering the report that I just mentioned that has just been released that shows that 70% of those monitoring stations, even in the United States, which are part of the historical climate network run by NOAA, this has shown that 70% of those monitoring stations are compromised or in some way flawed that makes their information questionable. If that's true with this group of monitoring stations, which is considered the best in the world, we were considered that ours is the best in the world, one might wonder what those monitoring stations in other countries look like and whether or not they have been flawed even more grotesquely than the flaws they found in our system in the United States. I find it prudent, I find it totally rational to move forward in having this type of quality control rather than just launching a national climate service without any insistence on quality for the statistics they're dealing with. So I support Mr. Neugebauer's amendment, which again would just mandate that any information that is obtained through monitoring, observing, and observing systems that are located in another country, that the National Academy of Sciences certify that these findings are accurate and verifiable. And I yield back the balance of my time, and again, would think that this would be, in any other Congress, I would know this should be a bipartisan issue. I have no idea why this is turning into a partisan vote. Thank you.
Mr. Rohrabacher yields back the balance of time.
Yield back the balance.
I now recognize myself for 5 minutes. This is similar to the previous amendments. That is correct. This is not about this amendment is not about good science. There are many measures in the bill to make sure that the science is as accurate as possible and improving. This particular amendment goes to information exchange agreements that we have with various countries. Most of which are other developed countries where the science is probably at least as good as our own. INPOS, for instance, because we will not get our INPOS satellite in place as quickly as we had hoped, we will almost certainly have to rely upon information from Europeans, all developed countries, all countries with rigorous academic standards, rigorous scientific standards, and this simply allows the National Climate Service to rely upon that data to the extent that they think that data is reliable. I yield back the balance of my time. Does any other member wish to be heard?
Mr. Chairman. Roscoe Bartlett here?
Yes, Mr. Bartlett.
I would like to yield my time to Mr. Rohrabacher.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bartlett. I'd like to put this in the record, Mr. Chairman. Here's a report from the National Academy of Science, which we rely on for their professional decisions and observations and analysis. And I would like to quote from it. And this is a report on the adequacy of climate observing systems by the National Academy of Science. Quote, deficiencies in the accuracy, quality, and continuity of the records, however, still place serious limitations on the confidence that can be placed in the research results. End of quote. Mr. Chairman, what are we doing on the Science Committee if we are not going to set up a system that is based on quality control and calling into question whether the National Academy of Sciences can actually do jobs like this, which is what their job is, what they're supposed to do. And again, I have no idea why this is looked at as a partisan vote. This should be a very easy vote. And so with that, I yield back the balance of my time and will call for a recorded vote on this amendment as well. Thank you.
Well, Mr. Rohrbacher, you posed the question to me. Will you yield to me such time
certainly
as I may
will,
need to answer?
I certainly will, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Rohrbacher, the bill goes to great lengths to assure that there is quality control. The best available science, which is not perfect science, and do you now yield back, Mr. Rohrbacher?
I yield back the balance of my time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Does any other member wish to be heard?
Excuse me. It was Mr. Bartlett's time.
I'm sorry. Does Mr. Bartlett yield back?
I yield back.
All right. Mr. Bartlett now yields back. The twice yielded time. Any other member wish to be heard? If not, we will proceed to a vote. All those in favor of the amendment say aye.
Aye.
All of those say no. No. The noes have it. And I believe Mr. Rohrbacher called for a recorded vote. The clerk will call the roll.
Chairman Gordon. Mr. Costello. Ms. Johnson. Ms. Woolsey. Ms. Woolsey votes no. Mr. Wu. Mr. Baird. Mr. Miller. Mr. Miller votes no. Mr. Lipinski. Mr. Lipinski votes no. Ms. Giffords. Ms. Giffords votes no. Ms. Edwards. Ms. Fudge. Ms. Fudge votes no. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes no. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes no. Mr. Griffith. Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Rothman. Mr. Rothman votes no. Mr. Matheson. Mr. Matheson votes no. Mr. Davis. Mr. Davis votes no. Mr. Chandler. Mr. Chandler votes no. Mr. Carnahan. Mr. Carnahan votes no. Mr. Heel. Mr. Heel votes no. Mr. Mitchell. Mr. Mitchell votes no. Mr. Wilson. Mrs. Dahlkepper. Ms. Dahlkepper votes no. Mr. Grayson.
No.
Mr. Grayson votes no. Ms. Cosmas. Ms. Cosmas votes no. Mr. Peters.
No.
Mr. Peters votes no. Mr. Hall.
Aye.
Mr. Hall votes aye. Mr. Sensenbrenner. Mr. Lamar Smith. Mr. Rohrbacher. Mr. Rohrbacher votes aye. Mr. Bartlett.
Aye.
Mr. Bartlett votes aye. Mr. Ehlers.
Aye.
Mr. Ehlers votes aye. Mr. Lucas. Mrs. Biggert.
Aye.
Mrs. Biggert votes aye. Mr. Aiken.
Aye.
Mr. Aiken votes aye. Mr. Nagebauer. Mr. Inglis. Mr. McCall.
Aye.
Mr. McCall votes aye. Mr. Diaz-Balart.
Aye.
Mr. Diaz-Balart votes aye. Mr. Bilbray. Mr. Bilbray votes aye. Mr. Adrian Smith.
Aye.
Mr. Adrian Smith votes aye. Mr. Brown.
Aye.
Mr. Brown votes aye. Mr. Olson.
Aye.
Mr. Olson votes aye.
Ms. Edwards, how do you wish to be recorded?
No.
Mr. Bilbray.
Ms. Edwards votes no.
Right. Mr. Bill, excuse me. Mr. Baird.
No.
Any other member wish to be recorded? Yes, Mr. Inglis.
No. Yeah,
Mr. Baird. Mr. Inglis votes aye.
And Mr. Inglis is aye.
Clerk will call the roll or announce the tally.
Mr. Chairman, 13 members vote aye and 21 members vote no.
The amendment is not agreed to. The 21st amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Hall. Mr. Hall, are you ready to proceed with your amendment?
I am, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment at the desk.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 009, offered by Mr. Hall of Texas.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection, so ordered.
Mr.
Chairman, I recognize the gentleman for 5 minutes to explain the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This amendment would prevent this bill, H.R. 2407, from forcing state, tribal, or local governments to shoulder the economic burdens that could be placed upon them by the federal government. And although this bill aims to encourage increased dialogue with state, tribal, and local governments, the fact that it's intended, or some think that it's intended to be included in H.R. 2454, that's the Markey bill, might change the intentions of the bill and could lead to financial burdens of these governmental entities that it intends to protect. The interagency amendment provides no hint as to what a National Climate Service would look like at the end of the three-year process. The blank slate, and I say the blank slate, and I kind of compare that. Mr. English and Mr. Baird had a very nonspecific or on structures of what a National Climate Service ought to even look like. So that blank slate that this amendment provides and could provide, and the authority to implement any structure chosen without further authorization from Congress, could very well lead to the formation of a, quote, Department of Climate Change, unquote, with regulatory authorities to implement a cap-and-trade regime. And that's the objection that we have. Such sweeping authority could constitute a financial burden on the state, tribal, and local governments. And my amendment would simply protect state, tribal, and local governments from federal overreach. This is particularly important right now when many states and cities are facing budgetary problems like that they've never experienced before. This is a responsible amendment. I urge all my colleagues to support it. I yield back my time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Without embracing all the arguments given in favor of the amendment, Mr. Gordon supports the amendment, and so do I. Does any other member wish to be heard?
Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Bilbray.
Look, I'm not going to – I just want to make sure that we clarify the bill as drafted. I think the motion is quite appropriate. I just think we've got to understand that if this bill was put together with Mr. Waxman and Mr. Markey's bill, the issue of traffic control and management as part of a emissions reduction is going to be a critical discussion that hasn't been talked right now. You can't talk about reductions without not only asking but requiring local government to synchronize traffic lights, eliminate stop signs when you go to yield signs, go to traffic circles instead of using four-way stops, intensification of development around mass transit centers. All of these are going to be requirements on local government down the pike. But that doesn't apply to this bill. But if this bill is tied to the Waxman-Markey, it is going to be an issue that we're going to have to discuss frankly and openly if we're going to really talk about emissions reductions, and I yield back.
Is there any further discussion? If no, the vote occurs on the amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. The ayes have it. Before we go into the 22nd amendment, I want to say thank you for saving some of the fun for me. My daughter had a longstanding a doctor's appointment, and so I'm sorry that I couldn't be here, but thank you for staying. The 22nd amendment on the roster is an amendment offered by the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Olson. You are ready to proceed with the amendment.
Welcome back, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment to desk and ask for its immediate consideration.
The clerk will report the amendment.
Amendment to H.R. 2407, amendment number 140, offered by Mr. Olson of Texas.
I ask unanimous consent to dispense with the reading without objection. So ordered, I recognize the gentleman for 5 minutes to explain the amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And my amendment is simple. It strikes the word "and change" from the text of the bill. The words "and change" follow every instance of climate variability in the text. And to me, using the word "change" is redundant. The word "variability" has the following meanings, just to name a few: apt or liable to vary or change, changeable, alterable, inconstant, fickle, having much variation or diversity. The purpose of this bill is to establish a National Climate Service, not a National Climate Change Service. A National Climate Service would seek to provide useful information to government and private sector decision makers about changes in climate such as drought, precipitation, ocean current oscillations like El Nino, and other relevant climate events that may impact present and future planning. Using the phrase "and change" permits the focus of the work to be diverted to the debate surrounding the causes of climate occurrences instead of keeping the focus on physical impacts of climate events. This committee has always put a premium on scientific fact, and my amendment would make certain this legislation has its intended impact. I urge its adoption and yield back my time.
Is there further discussion on the amendment? If not, the vote occurs on the amendment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. No. Those have it, and the amendment is not agreed to.
Mr. Chairman, I ask for a recorded vote, please.
The clerk will call the roll.
Chairman Gorton.
No.
Chairman Gorton votes no. Mr. Costello. Ms. Johnson. Ms. Woolsey.
I recognize Mr. Aiken for an amendment.
Ms. Woolsey votes no. Mr. Wu.
Okay.
Mr. Baird. Mr. Miller. Mr. Miller votes no.
Yes.
Mr. Lipinski.
No.
Mr. Lipinski votes no. Ms. Giffords. Ms. Edwards. Ms. Fudge. Ms. Fudge votes no. Mr. Lujan. Mr. Lujan votes no. Mr. Tonko. Mr. Tonko votes no. Mr. Griffith.
No.
Mr. Griffith votes no. Mr. Rothman.
No.
Mr. Rothman votes no. Mr. Matheson.
No.
Mr. Matheson votes no. Mr. Davis.
No.
Mr. Davis votes no. Mr. Chandler.
No.
Mr. Chandler votes no. Mr. Carnahan.
No.
Mr. Carnahan votes no. Mr. Hill. Mr. Hill votes no. Mr. Mitchell.
No.
Mr. Mitchell votes no. Mr. Wilson. Mrs. Dahlkepper.
No.
Mrs. Dahlkepper votes no. Mr. Grayson.
No.
Mr. Grayson votes no. Mrs. Cosmas.
No.
Mrs. Cosmas votes no. Mr. Peters.
No.
Mr. Peters votes no. Mr. Hall.
Aye.
Mr. Hall votes aye. Mr. Sensenbrenner. Mr. Lamar Smith. Mr. Roybacher.
Yes.
Mr. Roybacher votes aye. Mr. Bartlett.
Aye.
Mr. Bartlett votes aye. Mr. Ehlers.
Aye.
Mr. Ehlers votes aye. Mr. Lucas. Mrs. Biggert.
Aye.
Mrs. Biggert votes aye. Mr. Aiken.
Aye.
Mr. Aiken votes aye. Mr. Nagebauer. Mr. Inglis. Mr. McCall.
Aye.
Mr. McCall votes aye. Mr. Diaz-Balart. Mr. Diaz-Balart votes aye. Mr. Bilbray. Mr. Bilbray votes aye. Mr. Adrian Smith. Mr. Adrian Smith votes aye. Mr. Brown. Mr. Brown votes aye. Mr. Olson. Mr. Olson votes aye. Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Wu.
I got to take directions.
Giffords.
Mr. Wu votes no.
Ms. Giffords.
Ms. Giffords votes no. Mr. Baird votes no. Mr. Inglis votes aye. Ms. Edwards votes no. Mr. Chairman, 13 members vote aye and 23 members vote no.
The noes have it. The amendment fails. Is there anyone else that has an amendment? Mr. Aikens.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Boy, I've seen a lot of amendments go down in flames here today, and I did wait around, just wanted to ask your simple opinion on something, Mr. Chairman, and let me start with the rules of the game. If you don't like it, I'm going to withdraw it, because I'm not going to waste everybody's time on any more votes, okay? This is just an honest attempt to try to make the bill a little bit better in a small way. Here's the deal. You got service elements. It talks about the National Climate Service. That's what the whole bill is about. And the section reads this way: conduct analysis of the studies relating to the effects of weather and climate on communities, including the effects of agricultural production, natural resources, energy supply, demand, recreation, other sections of economy. Basically, they're saying climate, how does it affect things? Well, climate affects a whole lot, and this is a pretty broad mandate. I'm not limiting that, but I thought it would be helpful to add just this idea, and that would be to add a section here which is would change the wording. Just by adding a certain thing, it's going to say, conduct analysis of studies related to the effects of weather and climate on communities. And this is, I'm adding, and the effects of the use of zero carbon emitting energies, including nuclear, wind, hydropower, and solar, on communities and including, et cetera. So all I'm doing is saying, when you're going to take a look at the effect of weather on all of these things like natural resources, energy supply, and agriculture, that we simply put in specifically the zero carbon emitting energies, which seems to be the main part of what's going on here. I think it just is a little more precise in directing the emphasis to be toward the zero carbon emitting kinds of energies. And there is a similar change further along in the bill, but that'll give you enough to tell you whether you like it or not. And I'm not going to ask for a roll call or anything else. If you don't like it, we just won't do it.
You know, this is first impression, and I know clearly you come with the best of intentions. It seems to me,
I don't always, but this time this, I am.
It seems to me that what's happening here, this is really an EPA. This is a monitoring effort, which is more an EPA rather than the climate service, which is trying to help communities and whatever mitigating. So, what I would like to do is, again, my first impression, again, this is EPA and outside of what we're doing. But so whether you can have a vote or not have a vote, you probably won't be successful. But that doesn't mean that we won't continue to try to look into this. And so that's, you wanted my opinion. There you have
well,
it.
Well, I appreciate that. And, I guess the main point was it seems like the whole point of things is CO2. And the CO2, that says there are certain things that don't emit CO2, and those ought to, it seems like to me, if you specify, then it tightens up a little bit what they're looking at, instead of just, it appears to be almost a wide open study, anything to do with weather kind of thing. I just thought that would help. If you're, I'm happy, Mr. Chairman, you can take it for what it's worth, and I'll withdraw the amendment so we don't waste everybody's time.
Before the gentleman leaves this item, would you yield?
I yield.
Mr. Chairman, I think one of the things we're really seeing in this discussion about emissions is life cycle. And I think the gentleman's onto something, yeah, that when we talk nuclear, and I'm a very, I'm very big supporter of it, but there is not just the operation of the plant, but the manufacturing, the fuel, the transport. When we look at what we've done with ethanol, we're all at once now, we've had to broaden it because the footprint, the life cycle. Which agency do you see, and how do we track the life cycle on so much of this for the science committee or for the science community? Where do we find the place in the federal bureaucracy to track the total life cycle of so many of these technologies?
Can I call you back in a couple?
I think the primary agency is going to be EPA, but you're certainly correct in the sense that life cycle is what we have to be looking at. You can be thrown off by whatever the last leg. So once again, we've had a subcommittee markup. This bill has been out. Actually, we even postponed this hearing for a week to have more input. It's been out there for some time. This is, something that we, at this point, doesn't look like it's going to be beneficial, but we would like to continue to work with you on that. And I say that, not to be dilatory, but to be honest with you. And If it's something that can't be added later, we'll give you what we think is a good reason for it.
I yield back.
Okay. Any further discussion? Does anyone else have? So are you withdrawing your amendment?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I withdraw the amendment.
Never offered it.
Okay. Does anyone else have an amendment? Oh, if no, then the vote is on the bill.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Robacher is recognized.
Information before we have a vote on the bill. The creation of a National Climate Service or a climate service program within NOAA is basically what we're looking at today. But there's disagreement within the science community about what data we're talking about here and who should have jurisdiction and whether or not, of course, whether this is necessary at all. But one thing, we can't necessarily define all of that, but at least we should define in the legislation, and we're going to be voting on this now, we need to know exactly what is meant by certain terms in the legislation. And I would like to ask Legislative Council, what is meant, the terms climate services and climate products are used 25 times in the legislation but are never specifically defined.
Service. One good example is to look at NIDAS and the drought information that they provide and put up on their website. That would be actually a product. And then when your states and different resource managers take that product and they actually need to utilize NOAA to turn that product around to make decisions, that then becomes a service.
Okay, so the product is putting some actual information about a drought or something like that, or maybe even more rain than they wanted on the internet, and utilizing it is
the information itself. But then when you need to utilize the agency, the personnel or whatever, to then then translate that information to whatever their specific decision they're trying to make or their specific local or regional issue, then that becomes a service that NOAA then provides.
All right. I thank you very much. I will have to say for the record that I still am confused about this and what exactly we are going to be justifying by the legislation, but thank you very much for doing this. I don't mean to be disruptive. I just wanted to make sure that's
No, I think that was a good question, and it also brings up a thank you that I should give to Ms. Williams and Ms. Frucci for the good job and the staff work that they've done on putting this together. Let me remind my friend, to a great extent, what we're doing here is setting up a process to create this service. And we're giving benchmarks, and so that there's going to be a lot of collaboration over the next really couple of years, in reaching out to different groups, different agencies on how this should best be done, as well as Congress. So, you know, we will continue to have input here. Are there any other amendments? If no, then the vote is on H.R. 2407 as amended. All those in favor say aye. Aye. All those opposed say no.
No.
In the opinion of the chairs, the ayes have it.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
On that, ask a recorded vote.
The clerk will call the roll.
Chairman Gordon.
Aye.
Chairman Gordon votes aye. Mr. Costello. Ms. Johnson. Ms. Woolsey.
Aye.
Ms. Woolsey votes aye. Mr. Wu. Mr. Wu votes aye. Mr. Baird.
Aye.
Mr. Baird votes aye. Mr. Miller.
Aye.
Mr. Miller votes aye. Mr. Lipinski.
Aye.
Mr. Lipinski votes aye. Ms. Giffords.
Aye.
Ms. Giffords votes aye. Ms. Edwards.
Aye.
Ms. Edwards votes aye. Ms. Fudge.
Aye.
Ms. Fudge votes aye. Mr. Lujan.
Aye.
Mr. Lujan votes aye. Mr. Tonko.
Aye.
Mr. Tonko votes aye. Mr. Griffith.
Aye.
Mr. Griffith votes aye. Mr. Rothman.
Aye.
Mr. Rothman votes aye. Mr. Matheson.
Aye.
Mr. Matheson votes aye. Mr. Davis.
Aye.
Mr. Davis votes aye. Mr. Chandler.
Aye.
Mr. Chandler votes aye. Mr. Carnahan.
Aye.
Mr. Carnahan votes aye. Mr. Hill.
Aye.
Mr. Hill votes aye. Mr. Mitchell.
Aye.
Mr. Mitchell votes aye. Mr. Wilson. Mrs. Dahlkepper.
Aye.
Mrs. Dahlkepper votes aye. Mr. Grayson.
Aye.
Mr. Grayson votes aye. Ms. Cosmas.
Aye.
Ms. Cosmas votes aye. Mr. Peters. Mr. Peters votes aye. Mr. Hall? Mr. Hall votes no. Mr. Sensenbrenner? Mr. Lamar Smith? Mr. Roybacher? Mr. Roybacher votes no. Mr. Bartlett? Mr. Bartlett votes no. Mr. Ehlers? Mr. Ehlers votes no. Mr. Lucas? Mrs. Biggert? Mrs. Biggert votes no. Mr. Aiken? Mr. Aiken votes no. Mr. Nagebauer? Mr. Inglis? Mr. Inglis votes aye. Mr. McCall? Mr. McCall votes no. Mr. Diaz-Balart? Mr. Diaz-Balart votes no. Mr. Bilbray? Mr. Bilbray votes no. Mr. Adrian Smith? Mr. Adrian Smith votes no. Mr. Brown? Mr. Brown votes no. Mr. Olson? Mr. Olson votes no.
The clerk will report the tally.
Mr. Chairman, 24 members vote aye and 12 members vote no.
I recognize myself to offer a motion. I move the committee favorable report, H.R. 2407, as amended to the House with the recommendation that the bill do pass. Furthermore, I move that the staff be instructed to prepare the legislative report and make necessary technical and conforming changes, and that the chairman take all necessary steps to bring the bill before the House for consideration. The question is on the motion to report the bill favorably. Those in favor of the motion will signify by saying aye. Aye. Opposed, no. The ayes have it. The bill is favorably reported. Without objection, the motion to reconsider is laid upon the table. Members will have two subsequent calendar days in which to submit supplemental, minority, or additional views. Okay, just before we leave, let me first very sincerely thank everyone for being here today. I think in a very few years, you're going to, with pride, tell your kids and grandkids if you had the chance to vote on this bill. And Dr. Ehlers is recognized for a final word.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate that. When we came in the room and started the meeting some time ago, it was bright and sunshiny, and now it's very stormy outside. That more or less matches my mood during the course of this meeting. It's a good bill. I had expected to vote for it. But when both sides become intransigent, it's very hard to reach agreement. And I would hope that this is not a pattern that we're going to be facing in the future. I think we could easily have worked out something that would be agreeable to all parties involved. And I just have to express my regret. The past few years, we've worked together very, very well in a bipartisan way. I think this is the most partisan meeting we've had under your jurisdiction, Mr. Chairman. And I just hope that's not setting a pattern for the future.
And with that, Mr. Chairman, I want to second what the professor has said, and I would also say that we've been given a very fair hearing with a fair chair, and those that substituted for you were very fair. And maybe we'll see a day when this committee, of all the committees in the House, ought to be a little closer together. I don't think we're gaining on you, but we want to hold our own, but we want to be constructive and we want to be appreciative, and we are.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. As I say, we've, unlike sometimes in past Congresses, there was a subcommittee meeting, there was consultation, there was a postponement of this markup for another week to allow additional consultation. It was difficult to deal with last-minute amendments. But I think that, I think you had an amendment that was accepted, one or more, had input into this from the very start, had input into it with the manager's amendment, as well as Mr. Baird and Mr. Inglis. So we'll this process goes forward. And
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Can I just say, my comments were not intended in any way to make negative comments about any member. I've served on the subcommittee dealing with this. I'm just saying I saw a pattern developing this afternoon that we haven't had before, and I just hope this is the last time we see that pattern developing.
I would agree, and it needs to go both ways. And this concludes the meeting. Thank you.